Kyle Petty just loves the North Carolina Motor Speedway in the month of March. He should. He's bagged over $400,000 in the past two Goodwrench 500 races. To Kyle, the Rock is more than just another stop on the NASCAR Winston Cup Tour.
Well, I think it means a lot just because it's just right down the road from where I live, for no other reason. But, you know, I've been here and watched my father win 10 or 11 times. And, you know, and then we've been on a streak here lately, and we've been able to come down here and win. And, you know, I think it means a lot to this team, the Stabco Racing, and to me personally. But, you know, it's just a place that we feel like we can go back to, and it'll take care of us. It's not going to be too mean to us. So we like coming here.
Today, the heir to the King's throne could reap another $240,000 because Prince Kyle is again on the pole. TNN Motorsports, proudly live from the North Carolina Motor Speedway, the Goodwrench 500. You can bet that Richard Petty is one proud papa. From his 29th starting position, the man who has won so often here knows that his oldest child may well be creating a dynasty of his own. Hello, everyone. I'm Steve Evans, and welcome to the most glorious day for racing anyone can ever remember here at Rockingham. The weather is just perfect. Now, Kyle Petty has so dominated this race, a lot of people actually expect him to win. And, Kyle, you do have a shot for the third time in a row at breaking the bank.
Yeah, we're going to give it a shot. You know, this Mellie Yalla Pontiac's been running good since we unloaded it. And, you know, John Wilson builds a great motor. Robin Pemberton set it up this time. We've got a new crew chief. So things are a little bit different, but we hope the results are the same.
Now, this is not the same car you ran a year ago.
No, it's not the same car. You know, when Robin came on board with us, we decided that we'd shake things up and try to do some different stuff. The other car didn't really fit the templates like we wanted it to, or like NASCAR wanted it to. So we decided to bring this one out. This car was built about the same time, but it hadn't been run as many races. So hopefully it'll work all right.
Have a good and, more importantly, a safe ride.
Thank you, man.
Okay, now his biggest fear has got to be a fleet of very fast Fords, led by the man in the number 11 car, Bill Elliott, outside the front row. Elliott obviously has fit perfectly into the Junior Johnson organization. Two races this year, he's been in the front row both times. Let's move back just a little bit to my good buddy, Glenn Jarrett.
Well, thanks, Steve. Another one of these fast Fords starts back here in seventh position. That is car number seven, Alan Kulwicki. Alan had a fine fourth-place finish at Daytona, and he is a past winner here at Rockingham. But the man that everybody fears on Sunday when these guys buckle up to do battle is starting here in eighth position right beside of Kulwicki, driver of the killer Chevy number three, the Intimidator, Dale Earnhardt. Dale, it's been since 1987 since you've won a race here at Rockingham. You feel like today might be today?
Well, I hope so. It's been a pretty good week for us. We've been running pretty consistent, qualified pretty good considering, so... You know, we're just looking for a good race, a good clean race. It's got great weather and everything. The fans are ready for it. I think it'll be competitive.
Well, 492 laps around this place. What's the strategy for winning here at Rockingham? Long way to go.
Man, you got to be here all day. That's the biggest worry on our part is being consistent, be smooth, and try to be here all day, make good pit stops and stuff. You know, Glenn, it's just a long day, and you got to be there at 10. If you're there at 10 and got the car in shape, I think you have a shot at winning.
Well, you can bet this guy will have a shot at winning anytime he buckles up. Let's go back up pit road to Steve Evans.
Glenn and I will be back in just a few minutes to talk to some more drivers here on the grid. But right now, let's go topside to our master racecaster, Mike Joy.
Thank you, Steve, and hello, everyone. And yes, there's more pressure than ever on these teams from Detroit auto manufacturers to win on the one circuit where U.S. car makes still dominate. Ford has posted a $50,000 bonus if a Thunderbird wins today's or any other of the Winston Cup races. Now, that's twice as much as the racetrack will pay today's winner. General Motors, meanwhile, has regrouped all of its motorsports efforts under one umbrella. That's meant good things for all the Chevrolet teams in the NASCAR garage, slim pickings for Pontiac and even less for Oldsmobile, and Buick is out. As for NASCAR, the sanctioning body has taken many steps lately to ensure a level playing field. For more on that, let's join the experts that'll call today's race with me, Neil Bonnet and Buddy Baker.
Neil? Thanks, Mike. We're down here in the garage area, and all these templates that you're looking at right now are the ones that are supposed to fit these Winston Cup cars, and believe me, they fit nowadays. Gary Nelson's the new cop on the block, and these things are fitting, or they don't race, do they?
Well, that's right, Neil. You know, we worked real hard over the winter to get all the crew chiefs to understand what we were after. Then down in Daytona, we got the message one more time. But here at Rockingham, everything's working real smooth.
Seems like everybody in the garage is content with it. Let's see what the rest of the crew chiefs think about this.
I'm down here with Steve Mill, crew chief for Mark Martin. Everybody around the country is wanting to know one thing.
here it's really tough to get through technical inspection this year with the templates and everything. Could you elaborate on it and tell us a little bit about it?
Well, it's a little bit tougher this year, buddy, based on the fact that the tolerance that they're allowing you to miss the template by is down to nothing. Last year, you could miss the template by an eighth, a quarter, three-eighths of an inch. It was kind of a subjective thing. Now it's like a go or no-go gauge. You either fit the template or you don't. And based on that, I think it's a whole lot fairer for everybody else. You know, there's not a missing by a little bit or you got to fit or maybe doesn't have to quite fit. But when you got to fit, you know everybody's right and you're real confident that NASCAR is doing the best job they can and keeping a level playing field in the competition real even.
Yeah, you can bet on that. Now back to Mike Joy.
Well, will it be Chevrolet or Ford today in the battle of the Detroit nameplates in the Goodwrench 500? TNN Motorsports, exclusive live coverage of the NASCAR Winston Cup Goodwrench 500, is brought to you by Havoline Formula 3 Motor Oil. Add more life to your car. By Miller Genuine Draft, cold filtered for real draft taste, so get out of the old, get into the cold. By Mr. Goodwrench and your participating GM dealers, keeping quality on the road. And by Goodyear, the unanimous choice of every NASCAR Winston Cup team. In Kyle Petty's pit, they're getting ready. Their man has a chance to start from the pole today and win in excess of $200,000. Stay with us for all the excitement of the Goodwrench 500.
Welcome back to Rockingham, North Carolina, and our live coverage of the Goodwrench 500. Well, there's another one of those pesky Fords. That is Mark Martin, the number six car, inside of row number two. And let's remember, this is a special racetrack for Mark. He won his first ever Winston Cup event right here back in 1989. Now, a pleasant surprise for the Ford folks in only his second outing in their mark. Brett Bodine, outside of row number two, the Kenny Bernstein crew catches on quick.
Well, we really have, you know, and that's a tribute to Ford Motorsports and what they've helped us, and of course bringing Ernie Elliott on as our engine builder, Dottie Richards the crew chief. The whole package has really come together, and you know, Daytona was a pleasant surprise to go down there and be really competitive, but to come to Rockingham and do what we've done all week, it's showing just how strong we are early in the season.
As a driver, can you tell the difference between the Buick and the Ford, a different sensation?
Well, the whole team has come together, and that's the feeling I've got, the difference, the fact that we've stepped our entire program up. Gives me a lot more confidence when I sit down in this Quaker State Ford than I've ever had, knowing that I've got the people behind me that I do.
Good luck to you.
Thank you very much.
All right, right now let's catch up on all the news with Mike Joy and this week's Havoline Update.
Stock Car Racing Super Bowl, the Daytona 500, rumbled and raced along without incident until lap 92. That's Bill Elliott up high, Ernie Irvin down low, and Sterling Marlin right in the middle of what would become a very expensive sandwich. 14 cars, including the King, Richard Petty, in his final 500, would be caught up in this spinning melee. Most would be retired from the race. The rest continue along crippled. As these three cars would pull away from the pack, Davey Allison, Mike Waltrip, and Morgan Shepherd. But with nine laps to go, the engine in Walter's Pontiac went sour, and it became a Thunderbird shootout. Davey Allison holds off Morgan Shepherd by 1.5 car lengths to win Stock Car Racing's richest prize, the Daytona 500. Four Fords head the point standings coming out of Daytona. Allison, Shepherd, Bodine, and Kulwicki. Dick Trickle, the first GM car to finish, is fifth in the point standing.
And, Mike, the most dominant Ford in recent Winston Cup competition has been the number 28 Ford of Davey Allison. He seems to have won everything. In addition to his victory at Daytona, he won the last two races that we saw here on TNN in last season. Davey, you guys just keep winning and winning and winning. It seems to come easy to you guys these days.
Well, you know, we've got a great team put together, Glenn. Larry McReynolds, Robert Yates have done a great job with the guys at shop. They're working awful hard. The cars have been driving great for me. So, you know, my job has been pretty easy. I've been lucky enough to be sitting in the seat.
Well, you guys got a little extra concern here now. We understand that you had to change engines after the last practice yesterday.
Well, we did. You know, we had a little engine problem yesterday afternoon. But if you'll remember back last year, there were three races that we had to change the engine on the morning of the race, and we went on to win those three. So I'm not real worried about the engine right now. I hope everything holds together. We're going to give it our best shot anyways.
Not worried is an understatement. He sounds like that's a good omen for him. Let's go back upstairs to Mike Joy.
And that could be a bad omen for the rest of the field. 40 cars are lined up here at the North Carolina Motor Speedway. Here's how they go. Kyle Petty, new track record in qualifying in a Pontiac. Bill Elliott alongside in a Ford in row one. In the second row, Mark Martin and Brett Bodine, both in Thunderbirds. In row three, Rusty Wallace's Pontiac, Ernie Irvin's Chevrolet. In the fourth row, Dale Earnhardt's Chevy and Alan Kulwicki's Ford. In row five, Kenny Schrader's Chevrolet, Davey Allison's T-Bird. In row number six, Dick Trickle, he's in a Ford, the Stavola car, and Jeff Bodine's Thunderbird. Harry Gantz Oldsmobile and Mike Waltrip's Pontiac in row seven. Back in row eight, Hutch Strickland, he's in a Chevy, so is Greg Sachs. In the ninth row, Dave Marcus and Dale Jarrett in Luminas. In the 10th row, there's Rick Mast and Bobby Hamilton, both in Oldsmobile. And as we look back through the rest of this field, Neil, this manufacturer's battle has really become something as they fire these engines.
Well, I tell you, Mike, the guys are really getting behind these factory cars and they're putting the money up there and the parts and pieces to make them run. The question is, who's going to be the dominant force? It goes back and forth, back and forth. Ford's certainly showing a lot of strength, but we're right here now with a Pontiac on the pole.
Buddy, back in the last of the factory days, it wasn't Chevy Olds and Ford. It was Chevy Ford and Dodge.
Yeah, that's true. But I tell you what, this manufacturer thing, that means as much to them as the driving championship. They're really going after this thing. They're putting up a lot of money for it. It's going to be exciting.
And it will be today as we embark on the second race of the 1992 Winston Cup season. So look at Kyle Petty's car and the rest of this 40-car field as they fire off and get ready to roll at the Rock. The field embarks on its first of three pace laps. One car taking a minute to get going down the end of pit lane, and now we'll rejoin the tail end of that field. It is a beautiful day here. Presently 62 degrees. It's going to 70. Those of you up shoveling the stuff in the Great White North, eat your hearts out. It's beautiful here at Rockingham for this race. A lot of smell of suntan oil out in the grandstand as we get set to go. We'll be riding along today with Mark Martin. You see up on the roof of that car, that's the roof cam that TNN pioneered last year. The Valvoline Ford Thunderbird. Now there's the 360-degree tilt and pan race cam. Standard fare for most of these telecasts. Also, we'll have a face cam looking at Mark from the dashboard of his Jack Roush-owned Thunderbird. And this view from the roof cam. You see a good idea of what Mark sees as he goes around Rockingham. We'll also be riding along with the Penske Racing Miller Genuine Draft Pontiac of Rusty Wallace. As the field comes around turn four down on the apron. And there's the view out the front windshield of Rusty's car. That's a fixed mount camera out the front. And similarly, there's one mounted in the rear deck. See the antenna there in the lower right. Wallace's car as he looks back on the grid to Alan Kulwicki, one spot back. Now we'll also have cameras inside Davey Allison's car, the Haviland Thunderbird. And like Rusty Wallace, he'll be showing us pictures from a camera that's mounted on the roll cage, fixed mount camera that faces straight ahead. See Davey there in the rear view mirror. Is that Velcro for the radar detector on the dash? And we'll be looking out the back window of his car as well. You gotta be careful down pit road.
Yeah, down pit road is about as dangerous as on a racetrack. We've seen them yesterday, several almost wrecked. They were wrecked, they just didn't happen.
That's it. Up in the banking of turn number two here at the Rock. And the Pontiac safety car is out in front of the field. Elmo Langley, former Winston Cup racer. He is the pace car driver. Shots from that vantage point as well for you today. 26 cars pit on the front side. Derek Cope qualified second day. There's Elmo from the dashboard of the safety car. And Derek went out to requalify to try to get in the top 26, and he got the last pit stop on the front stretch. And in the garage area, a lot of folks feel that that's necessary if you're going to win this thing. You've got to pit on the front rather than the back. Pace car is in as you saw Elmo bring that car to a halt. And we are ready to let fly with the Goodwrench 500. Green flag. Pontiac and Ford on the front row and on the brake. To no one's surprise, Kyle Petty.
I think the surprise is going to be how big a break, Mike. He's shown so much strength here year in and year out. They're just wondering if they can even hang on to him now.
Pontiac, three Fords and a Pontiac. 492 laps here. Those three Fords are Elliott, Brett Bodine, then Rusty Wallace, who's hit Mark Martin for the fourth spot. Alan Kulwicki is sixth, Ernie Irvin seventh. Dale Earnhardt is eighth, Davey Allison ninth, Kenny Schrader tenth. Riding with Rusty Wallace. Along the front straightaway. Brett Bodine just ahead of Rusty in those familiar Quaker State colors, but that's a Ford this year for Kenny Bernstein's team. Buick is out of Winston Cup racing. Turning their attentions elsewhere in the motorsports arena.
Boy, that shot right there makes you wonder, Mike, how a guy can have something at certain racetracks. Everybody used to say, well, he's got a certain car that runs at Rockingham, but at the top of the show, we made fact known that they brought a different car here. Kyle's still able to have a stout run with them and with a different race car this time.
Right, Neil, we saw Darrell Waltrip there trying to make his move. Started back in 24th spot. Climbed four positions. Lap four. Waltrip working way up to the outside of Morgan Shepherd, the Daytona 500 runner-up. And Dave Marcus in the blue car debuts a new sponsor, Abilene Boots. They rode with him in the 500. Guess he had to abandon his old wingtips he used to drive in.
I can't imagine him driving anything but wingtips. He probably wears his boots at night, don't you think?
They must make him wingtip cowboy boots then. Morgan Shepherd in the Wood Brothers car. And Darrell Waltrip back there midfield.
You know what's unusual about the preferred line is usually the inside of this racetrack. Darrell, through year in and year out, likes to run high on his racetrack. He sets his car up to run high, and a lot of times later in the race, he's in good shape with that.
Waltrip in 19th position. Race about 9th position here as Davey Allison draws in on Earnhardt.
Boy, Davey is really sticking nicely on the bottom of the racetrack. Started coming on, the longer he run, the better he run. That's the tendency of that car of Davies down here. Oh, Earnhardt's loose. You see the back of that car?
Now that doesn't surprise you.
Well, I don't think he wants it that loose. No. You see him dropping back. It's very seldom he'll pull over and let somebody go.
Let's see what he can do with Davey now.
When that loose condition really occurs, it's just like we saw that right then. Davey stuck the nose of the car right under Earnhardt. All of a sudden, the car breaks loose. It takes air off that rear spoiler. So it's kind of a defensive play and offensive play. You know, it really affects the guy in front of you when you do that.
Back in the field. Well back behind this battle. There's Richard Petty running in 27th spot. Qualified 29th. He and Derek Cope pulling up on Sterling Marlin and Ricky Rudd. Back up front, Bill Elliott is running down Kyle Petty. Now, those wheelbarrows full of bonus money apply only if Kyle wins the race from the pole. From the outside pole, Elliott's potential winnings approximately $45,000. If he goes to victory lane.
I tell you what, Bill Elliott's getting in the corner a lot faster than Kyle is right now. I don't know whether the chassis getting loose or what.
Buddy, you hit the nail. Hit what's right here as they enter the corner. This is when Bill runs all over him, getting down in the corner. And boy, if you get a car that gets loose getting down in the corner here, you're in trouble. Here's Elliott going to drive up under him coming off the fourth turn.
And the fans come to their feet. And the Ford leads a lap for the first time today.
Mike, I guess that answers one question. Everybody wonders, can anybody race with Kyle Petty? It looks like they can real early.
Not only can he run with him, he's going away from him right now.
That's Andy Belmont low on the track apron. He'd been black flagged on the start of this race. So it's Elliott who's going to wander off from the field now for a while.
Yeah, you know, Bill's pulling away, but it's a combination. Kyle is dropping back. He's having some kind of trouble because the third place car is really gaining on him too.
Here's that battle again. Darrell Waltrip and Morgan Shepherd continuing to move up. They are closing in on Jeff Bodine in the Bud Moore car, number 15. Great story here on the starting grid of the Daytona 500. Bodine said, you know, I've been watching the Olympics on TV and watching those guys on the bobsled. They got good pushers, but they need a driver, somebody that understands the banking and the G-forces. I want to go drive a bobsled. And Tuesday he will at Lake Placid, New York. The bobsled organizing committee has invited him up to audition for a seat.
I'm going to tell you, he's going to meet reality head on there when he gets in that bobsled. That's a whole different story from race car that turns the minute you turn the wheel.
I can't wait. We're going for a ride up there. I'll let you know how it turns out.
Oh, you're going with him?
Yep. Wish I'd been to Buck Baker School first, but I guess he'll have to wait till after.
Neil, we better really learn what we're doing up here if he's going to ride in the bobsled.
There won't be any discussion about horsepower, that's for sure. Darrell Waltrip is underneath Bodine. Jeff could probably use a little bit of bobsled right here. That opens up the bottom groove, but Shepard's going to go up with the Ford. Hold position for the moment. Waltrip in 17, 15 is Bodine, 21 is Shepard. Bobby Hamilton coming into the picture, last year's Rookie of the Year. And here comes Morgan on the outside. See a lot of cars that are just not stuck to the bottom of the racetrack, even this early in the race.
Mike, you know what's unusual about that? As we talked about at the top of the show, it's clear as a bell. There's not a cloud in the sky, and it's the same way it's been since they unloaded the cars. If you've ever had the opportunity to set a car up for a race, it's been this week. There's not a cloud in the sky. You can't say the sun's out, the sun's in. You don't have any excuses this today. You've got to have it ready. Things have been perfect all week long.
Let's move up, Neil, and look at the race for third. Here's Brett Bodine. The Quaker State T-Bird and the Miller Pontiac for Rusty Wallace closing in.
Yeah, Rusty's working real well, too. He looks like he's gaining a little bit on Brett going in the corner also. You see him gain there? Brett's car is handling extremely well. The back end sucks right down. Just as I said that, he turned sideways.
He heard you. Rusty is there. Third and fourth at stake here. Elliott leads. Kyle Petty is second. This is the race for third. Del McCowart there is a pick.
See if it loosens the Quaker State car getting in the corner before when you drove up behind Earnhardt and got him loose, but it looked like Brett Bodine's car was sticking a little bit better.
Derek Cope having trouble early, changing four tires on the Purolator Chevrolet, which is now crew chief by Barry Dodson, at least for this weekend. Doug Williams departed that team early in the week.
Neil, that looks like he may have had a tire equalizer or something, because he's changing all four this early. It has to be some big problem with the vibration or something.
Yeah, you know, it's hard to pick which one it is, and everybody says, well, tell me which tire it is. The vibration is so bad, there's no way to tell. You just have to change all four of them.
Left rear tire was down on that car. They changed all four. Now Mark Martin has come out to make this a three-car race for third, within striking distance of Kyle Petty. Nineteen laps in.
You see Mark Martin getting into this little battle here with Bodine and Rusty too.
And there's Dale Earnhardt working underneath Ernie Irvin, the eighth place car. Or is that Irvin going around the outside of Dale?
Temporarily, Dale going around the four car.
So eighth changes hands. Put Earnhardt in eighth behind Kulwicki. They lap past the Randy Baker car. Irvin to ninth, and there's Kenny Schrader right in the picture in tenth in the Kodiak Chevrolet.
If people think the factors aren't involved, we're looking at a fleet of Fords up front, and here's Chevrolet's strongest contingent, the three of them running right there together in eighth. So, you know, the guys got work to do. They've got to do some work at the factories to close them back up.
And there's the Gantt Mobile. We used to call it Oldsmobile, but since Harry won all their races last year, we got to call it the Gantt Mobile.
Dave Marcus just blew a motor going into turn one down here.
Uh-oh. Stepped up his boots, did he? We'll get a caution flag. First one of the day, lap 22. Dave Marcus lets down a big plume of smoke in the back straightaway.
See Dave beating on the steering wheel there. He certainly didn't need that. He's upset. Someone like Dave, it's hard to afford those kind of deals.
Happy birthday, Dave. 51 today. Not a good way to celebrate. Bill Elliott had built up a 3.8 second lead. in that first run of green flag racing. And here's Marcus coming in. He's going to take it right to the garage area.
Neil, one thing you can bet on, those cars that were running loose, they won't be loose after the stop. They'll be turning those bolts on the back there, trying to tighten those cars up. But it's a miserable place to drive when you're loose.
Before the race started, we noticed there was more spoiler angle on these cars than I've ever seen in cars. Short tracks, you don't know the angle they're running here. They're having a hard time tying the rear of these cars down on a hot day like we have now with a lot of sun. So they've still got some work ahead of them to tighten them up.
Well, Bill Elliott will stay out on the racetrack, but as you saw behind him, almost everybody else comes to pit road. Kyle Petty, Brett Bodine, Rusty Wallace, Mark Martin, Davey Allison, Alan Kulwicki, Dale Earnhardt, Ernie Irvin, Ken Schrader and Harry Gant, the way they were running at the time of the caution. Here's the pits of the pole sitter.
You know, I have to question that call on Elliott. They've run 24 laps already, and I guess he feels those tires are working well and the car was running up front without any problem, but four tires and chassis adjustment might put him in a little bit of a problem when they start back.
Well, sure, but what's not to like about the way that car was running? We'll see.
Yeah.
I saw Jim Long there in the picture back at the rear tires. Car owner Felix Sabati gave Jim a Rolex watch. So they're rewarding the crew for that pole run. And Felix, who has been known to spread the good stuff around, has promised engine builder John Wilson that if Kyle wins this race today, John will get a brand new Pontiac Grand Prix. Whew. We are 25 laps into the Goodwrench 500. Bill Elliott stayed on the racetrack. He continues to lead. We'll be right back. Getting ready for the restart here at Rockingham. That's Randy Baker down on the inside. He's a lap down. He'll be joined in the low lane by Derek Cope, who lost two laps on a green flag pit stop. Here's the way they're running at 26 laps. Mike Skinner did not stop. The rest of the field did. So he's behind Elliott. There's your top 10. Ernie Irvin was ninth at the time of the caution flag, had a long stop, came out 18th.
This should be a good gauge for us, Mike, to see how much new tires affect the car. Elliott didn't stop. He's got old tires on, rusty, and all the guys right behind him put new tires except for the second place car, and we'll just see if they can do anything with Elliott.
Green flag, second one of the day.
You know, during the week, I'm sure Junior and them had a gauge of what, when they put new tires on, what, how much they gained and what they lost, and if the car's handling well, well, we're going to find out pretty quick here. It looks like Rusty's going to be on him pretty heavy here.
Wallace is there right behind Bill Elliott. Well, it's such a different game with the radial than the bias fly tires. Here comes Rusty.
That answered the question, I think.
Caught Bill up to the high side. Pontiac and Pontiac, the double team before.
Yeah, it's... I knew I was right when I said it. I don't know why I questioned myself.
There's just no way to overcome a brand new tire for two or three laps. I'm not saying that Elliott can't wheel them back in, but I bet you see him put tires on the next stop.
Challenge for the lead right here. The two Pontiacs go at it. And Kyle Petty retakes the lead. Let's go to Glenn Jarrett.
Well, guys, I asked Jim Brewer, crew chief on Bill Elliott's Ford, if that was indeed their plan not to pit or miscommunication. He said no. That they talked it over, they felt the car was performing well. They felt like the new tires might be quicker for a few laps, but then the field would come back to them. So Tim's sitting here mighty nonchalant right now. He doesn't look like he's got a care in the world. They've dropped back to third, but they feel like that the race can come back to them.
Well, let's see. That was Felix Sabat, as you saw, the fellow who owns Kyle Petty's car.
You think he ordered a Rolex just in case and a Pontiac so he could pay everybody off today?
Might have. Two in a row, Kyle has won from the pole in this race. Over 400 grand. Here are the Fords now. Will they work together or will they battle for position? Three of them, Elliott, Martin, and you're riding with Davey Allison. Andy Belmont has taken his car to the garage. Davey's going after it on the outside.
Well, Neil, he's handling good down the straightaway again this race.
Yeah, I talked to him this morning. They were concerned about changing motors, and Larry McReynolds told me, he said, you know, Houston, when we change motors, I was concerned. He said, every time we change motors race morning, we win. So that's, he said, I'm always asking Robert, let's change this morning.
Yeah.
They got their wish today. They got a new one in there.
Davey said the last lap of practice yesterday, I felt like it was about to seize. Riding with Mark Martin, getting active behind him. Those three Fords are about to be joined by a black Chevrolet.
Yeah.
Guess who? Up front, two Pontiacs, Kyle Petty, Rusty Wallace. Keeping close tabs on one another. Then the three Fords.
Oh, that's nice. Look at that windshield. That has to be fun. That's not too bad right now, but later on today, as that sun starts down over turn one, believe me, that can be a problem right there.
Let's go back to sixth spot. There's the battle. You see Earnhardt, he's cleared that pack. So too is Harry Gant. Then it's Alan Kulwicki, Brett Bodine, Dick Trickle in the Stavola car, along with Hunt Strickland, Darrell Waltrip, and Dale Jarrett. That's a GM pack, pretty much.
You got it.
Everybody's really running inside the racetrack. Somebody's going to get have to play around with that outside lane and see if they can get the cars working out there on the outside.
Everybody on the bottom.
Davey Allison just went around and moved into third. Around Elliott, he's fading further back.
Those radial tires may be good for more than four or five laps. of advantage, four or five laps of advantage over worn tires.
You know, here we are looking at Elliott just dropping back and dropping back. It's just simple. You wear the rubber off the tires, you're down on the lower tread, and it's no different. When you get them worn completely out, they're not as good. And he's just got a little less tire than the other guys. He can't keep up right now.
But can you win this race five laps at a time like this?
I don't know if you can win it five laps at a time, but when you're up front, you're out of trouble more often.
Mike, it may not be that much faster than your tire, but they last longer. What Neil is saying is he's used his tires up. His good part was way back in the race there when he run real fast, and now you got a situation where everybody else is on better tires than him, and they're just eating him alive.
The Gillette Halfway Challenge is part of today's telecast. The driver leading at halfway wins $10,000, and one fan at home will get a chance to win a new Chevy Lumina Z34. Here's the number to call. You'll be charged 95 cents for that call. You must be 18 or over to enter. And must call before the halfway lap to be eligible for today's drawing. If you're called at home and can name the driver who wins it, we'll tell you who that is. You could win that car.
Look at this. Does this remind you of last year a little bit? Here comes Harry Gant.
And it's not even September. I guess it doesn't have to be. Oh.
Mike, here's Davey. He's right on the rear bumper of Rusty Wallace. And he's running all over the two guys that are right in front leading the race. Davey's trying on the outside. That's not an easy place to do it, but he's been passing him on the outside of the racetrack.
Two Pontiacs are joined by the Ford of Davey Allison. There's his view of Rusty Wallace just ahead. Davey won here last fall on TNN. Look at that glare from the sun.
We're looking out of Rusty's car now. We're going to have to talk to him. They're cleaning his side to win. They're leaving our side dirty.
I just wonder who's doing that to his windshield. What car he's been following is losing that much fluid.
Doesn't take much, just that little bit of spray. See how clean the back window is.
Mike, here's a good example. We're looking through this rear window right here with these rear window straps. That shows you how much downforce, how much aerodynamic design. Look at that window buckling with just the air rolling over that back window, laying on the spoiler.
Generate a lot of air pressure going around here at 150 miles an hour. Most airplanes will take off at that speed or less.
And that is Davey. We're looking at the front window, so things have changed in that one lap.
Second place. Steve?
Earlier, you talked about John Wilton, the engine builder for Kyle Petty. I talked to John this morning and some other engine builders. I asked them all the same question. Which is the most durable, the General Motors power plant or the Ford? And they all said, well, they're very close. If there's an edge, though, it goes to the GM product because due to the horsepower and torque curve of the Ford, a lot of them have to run a slightly lower rear axle ratio. That means more RPMs, and over a long race like this, those RPMs can add up a lot of wear and tear.
Good point. Well, right now they're wearing and tearing on the front spot. Kyle Petty, Davey Allison, Rusty Wallace.
Man, that's impressive. Did you see him just pass Kyle down the straightaway and drive away?
He's had to pass almost all the key figures in this race on the outside of the racetrack, and that's impressive where he's going.
Well, nobody will give him the bottom. Doesn't need it, does he?
The only thing now, he can pick whichever real estate he wants. He's leading this thing. He can pick any part he wants now.
There's one more car on the move that's about to catch that pack, and that's Earnhardt. There's that lead pack. Mark Martin there in fourth spot, number six. Now a four-car train, and the black car moving up.
Mark's car is really working good right in the middle of the corner. He'll roll down in the corner right behind the two car, and he makes a real, real strong move right in the middle of the corner to get right back on the back bumper, especially down in one and twos where he's really putting the heat on.
Second, third, and fourth place we're watching. Petty, Wallace, and Martin.
One thing Neil just mentioned about the sixth car, one thing Jack Roush is not afraid to do, and that's turn RPM. That Ford really rips some RPMs down the straightaway, and I guarantee you from the center corner to the straightaway, nobody beats that car.
We have completed 46 laps here at the Goodwrench 500. Davey Allison leading, Kyle Petty in second, Rusty Wallace in third, Mark Martin and Dale Earnhardt. That's the front five.
Yep.
And we'll be back with more of the Goodwrench 500 after these messages. And some thoughts from Rusty Wallace on the 1992 season ahead.
It's going to be a proving season for a lot of drivers, a lot of teams. A lot of drivers have switched manufacturers and cars. A lot of them went to Ford. A lot of them went to Chevrolet. I'm with the Pontiac still. The new cylinder head rules have been changed. The engine rooms have been working day and night, perfecting the heads. And so it's going to be a lot of, it's going to be a proving season for a lot of people trying to make a point. It's going to be a season for people to make up what they didn't get done last year.
TNN Motorsports exclusive live coverage of the Goodwrench 500 is brought to you by NAPA, because there are no unimportant parts. Davey Allison is in the pits, as are most of the leaders. We are under caution. Dale Jarrett earlier had pitted under green, now is back in, and the caution has come out just moments ago for a backstretch incident principally involving Alan Kulwicki. Davey accelerating out of the pits, and there is underhood difficulties with the Jarrett car.
Mike, it looks like they've been working with the ignition system. They were inside the car working with that, and right now it looks like they're just trying everything to fix it.
Neil, something's on fire under there. I don't know what it is. Oh.
Carburetor fire. Looks like.
The thing was backfiring and missing, and I guess it coughed back and caught it on fire.
They got a pretty good fire under there now. Oops.
Air filter.
Yeah, air cleaner's on fire.
Glenn Jarrett.
This is most unusual. It is a carburetor fire. The car had an ignition problem. When he pinned it a while ago in the green, they got that fixed. The car went out. It sounded a little rough. It sounded like the car, maybe the carburetor loaded up a little bit. And sure enough, when he came back in, it had doused the top side of the carburetor and the fuel filter with gasoline, caught it on fire. I've been racing a long time, and you don't see that too often. That's supposed to be relatively unburnable material, if that's the correct word. But they do have the fire put out right now, but they still got some problems. The engine is shut off.
I think you're right, Glenn. I think it's more the gasoline that came up through the carburetor is probably what was what ignited there. Let's have a look at what brought out this caution flag, the second of the day on lap 52.
Mike, this thing started back in the middle of the corner. Kulwicki got down under Earnhardt. They were side by side, and they got together going down the back straightaway.
It looked like Kulwicki thought he was cleared and turned over in front of Earnhardt is the way it looked.
We should be able to see it in this angle.
Yeah, that's what he did. Earnhardt's holding his own on the outside, and he come on across anyway.
You know, all day yesterday, we saw people try to climb that wall, and it's impossible to do when it's starting again today. It really tears some equipment up in that off turn two over there.
So Kulwicki is in the garage area trying to make repairs for the Hooters Thunderbird, and Dale Jarrett's Interstate Batteries car is going to the garage as well.
Here we go. We got a
There's Earnhardt on the outside, Quickie on the inside.
See him come across.
And he moves
He's
over.
He's in his lane there now.
Yep, he thought he'd cleared him and nowhere to go on the outside. Just moved over. And now you're going to see a pretty good shot off of that wall.
You know what else that tells us? That Earnhardt car is indestructible.
It'd take a pretty good stick of dynamite on a given day to get it off the racetrack. It can take some pretty good licks.
Look at Daytona when he was in the middle of that big wreck and all he did was knock all the Bondo off the fender.
I got to tell you something else. That guy driving that car has a lot to do with the way it gets through stuff. You notice he didn't spin. He didn't get in trouble. He just turned down and got out of the way.
You're riding with Mark Martin under caution. Second one of the day. We're at lap 55 and Rusty Wallace led the race out of the pits. Davey Allison in second. Martin is the third place car.
Have we got a camera crew or what? They get everything.
Good job. Good job. John Mullins producing today's telecast. Gary Clems, our director, bringing you these fine pictures. Peter Larson and the folks from BST in charge of our in-car cameras.
Mike, Rusty's crew is really on the ball this time. The first stop they made this time, the first pit caution, they were out real, real early, put him in contention. They got him out real, real quick again. Now he's leading the race. They're really doing a job in the pits for him today.
Here's the running at 55 laps. Pontiac, Ford, Ford, Pontiac Oldsmobiles, the front five. Then it's four Chevrolets and Richard Petty's Pontiac. Second caution flag of the day. Alan Kulwicki, former winner here, in the garage. We'll look for green this time by at lap 56. Derek Cope, two laps down, is up there in the front of the bottom lane along with Randy Baker. And Mike Skinner is the third car in line, the Glidden Paints car there. Ready to run once again. Restart.
That's a good route. Rusty to get down and get on that bottom lane. See, I left Davey out there. Just you have to go around the car. And at one corner, it really holds you up.
And look at the differential. Wallace had that last start as a pick.
So this is a view Rusty Wallace would like to have all day long, looking at the back window at everybody.
Right. Dale Earnhardt trying to come back up through between Hut Strickland and Darrell Waltrip. Waltrip started 24th. He's now 6th. You don't usually see him this far up front this early.
Now he usually sits there by this time and works on his car all day and gets a chassis a little better, shows up at the end. But this might be an indication he's ready to go racing early.
Yeah, and it's good to see that Earnhardt didn't really hurt his car when he got up against the wall on the backside over there.
6th, 7th, and 8th. Hunt Strickland in the 8th spot in the Bobby Allison Ray Vestas car.
Looks like he tried it on the outside there and it slid up a little bit, buddy. And they might have to play around, check some toe end or something on the car. Because, you know, that thing's pretty tough, but it's hard to take a lick like that.
You know yourself, there ain't no such thing as hitting easy here.
You're right.
Kenny Schrader coming into the picture and Richard Petty in the top 10. Here's Davey Allison getting underneath the lapped car, the Purelator Chevrolet for Derek Cope. Going to drag Mark Martin right along with him in the Valvoline car. Up the racetrack just a little.
It looks like Davey's car is a little bit tight right now. You know, first the race he could do about anything he wanted to do, and looks like he's a little bit tight. But, buddy, that's an indication reason maybe the longer they run, the better he gets.
Yeah, I think so. That car is really handling super good. And look at old Harry again. He don't know it's not September again.
No. Anthem's coming right up in the picture here. He's the fifth place car. 1 second is the advantage for Rusty Wallace. That's about 8 car lengths on this racetrack. Mark Martin will look back from his car.
Dal Petty back there behind him. I tell you, Cal has got a really use his head today. Even though you got a car that might lead the race, they've got so much on the line to win this thing. He's got to keep that thing out of trouble all day. We heard him say early, we got to be there. You got to be there at the end of the race. Him and Earnhardt talking about that. The key is to get 450 miles behind you, then try to win the thing. And they might use their head a little bit today and try to save some of that race car for the end.
He's in fourth place right now behind Mark Martin. Kyle's two victories from the pole put him fourth on the list of winners for this race. Behind Richard Petty with 7, David Pearson and Cale with 3, Bobby Allison and Neil Bonnet, 2 apiece. Along with Kyle Petty. Harry Gant closing in on them now.
Mark Martin's running super good, too. He's just moving right along here.
And Davey Allison, you see, reeling in Rusty Wallace. About a half a second lead now.
Yeah, as we were talking about, I'm not so sure Davey's car is not going to be tight on every restart and come to him a little bit. I think that's one of Larry McReynolds' strong suits. He can make the car run good late in the race. Every time we talk to him, he always says, "Boy, I want it to go green. I want it to go green." That's nice to have that.
We're at 64 laps, Neil. Rusty Wallace the leader, Davey Allison, Mark Martin in Ford, Kyle Petty and Harry Gant the front five. There's the rest of the top 10, four GM cars and Bill Elliott four. We'll be right back. The laps complete in the Goodrich 500 at Rockingham, and it's once again Davey Allison's turn to run out front. Mark Martin in second, Rusty Wallace is third, Harry Gant is fourth. You'll see Gant creep into the picture right there.
Yeah, that's not creeping, he's flying right now.
Well, Mike, I tell you what, Davey Allison pulled out, looks like 15 car lengths in two laps. If they keep this ritual up, they'll be putting the motor out of the tow truck in there all week long and change every Sunday morning.
You're exactly right, Neil. The longer that car runs, the better it gets under green. Rusty Wallace's view of Mark Martin's car. And Mark Martin looking back at Rusty.
Rusty was leading this thing four laps ago, and now he's running third, one guy checking out on him. Here comes Harry Gant, threatening to take third place away from him.
Gant coming on strong. Green car behind him, Stanley Smith, a lap down. Andy Belmont in the garage along with Alan Kulwicki and now Dale Jarrett with internal engine trouble. Race for seventh spot. Kenny Schrader gets around or gets underneath Dale Earnhardt once again. Little tap. Close.
You know, Neil, ever since that little incident with Alan Kulwicki on the back straightaway, Earnhardt's car is not coming off the corner like it did. It looks like it's pushing. I think he may have the toe end knocked off a little bit on it.
Yeah, you're bouncing around like that, and the tie rods are probably the weakest thing on the front suspension, and they might have to get the string out and recheck that thing on a few caution blades.
The thing is, you could beef up the tie rods, but then the ball joint, something else would be the weak link, and that'd be more trouble.
They almost do it purposely. You have one weak link in the chain where you repair it.
Here's Richard Petty, who started way back in the field and has now come from 29th on the grid up to the top 10. Racing with Ernie Irvin and the Stavola car. Dick Trickle, the new driver for Bill and Mickey Stavola in the 8 car. Bill Stavola is not here. He's up north. He's in Minnesota ice boat racing. Qualified for the finals in his event up there, and so he's on one of those little ice boats on a frozen lake in Minnesota while we're down here in the sunshine.
You got to explain that to us from the south. What is an ice boat? Is that one of the things with a sail that goes along on top of the ice with three runners on it?
You take a 12-foot 2x4, and then crossways you put about a 6-foot 2x4, and you put ice skates on the bottom and a big sail up on top.
Okay.
Yeah. Same weather we're having here, I'm sure.
Yeah, I hope not. There'll be ice boat paddling if it is.
Well, they made the change to Ford this year, and they picked their program up some. It seems like they've really got on top of things real quick.
Three wide down the front straightaway, lapping past Jimmy Mean's car, Darrell Waltrip, trying to fend off Derek Cope, who is two laps down, and here's Bill Elliott, right with Waltrip. That'll be sixth place.
Mike, if we've ever seen what happens in track positioning, you're seeing it right now. You know, Bill was the guy checking out early, got out of sync a little bit. It's going to take him a while to work it. I don't doubt once he gets back to the front, he might be able to do what he did before. But once you get out of sync on track positioning in a place like Rockingham, it takes a long time to get it back.
And here comes the other Junior Johnson car, Sterling Marlin, with the Maxwell House Ford. Coming up to battle, Mike Waltrip and Ricky Rudd for 17th. It's just as hard in the middle of the pack as you do up front.
Oh, yeah, there's not any easy racing at Rockingham, believe me.
You know, Mike Walker from their team has really got to be enthusiastic after the great run they had at Daytona, which came up a few laps short, but shows the strength that they have. Billy Engel and that crew really got Michael running.
Sterling Marlin just didn't quite hit it here, qualified 25th. And has run up in the late 20s most of the day. You see Terry Labonte just ahead of that group, along with Brett Bodine. Here's Earnhardt with Hutch Strickland. Now Kenny Schrader has gone by those cars. You see Schrader move up. And let's check with Glenn Jarrett.
Well, Mike, for once I was paying attention when you speculated Earnhardt might have some problems, so I asked Richard Childress, did he do some damage to the car in that brush there?
Yeah, we think, you know, the car is working good before, and now it's picked up a bad push off the corner, so we think we bent the toe in, so we're going to try to take a look at it. We're having a little brake problem right now, too, with that side, so we'll just have to see.
All right, is it something that you can fix if you get the chance?
Yeah, I think we can work on it if a lot of right time comes.
Right now, he's just trying to stay out there, stay out of trouble, stay on the lead lap, give him a chance to look at that thing.
That tie rod on that car, that's the one piece I guess you'd want to be the weakest link, because it's the one you can most easily adjust. If you bend an A-frame or something else, that's real trouble.
It turns to major surgery when you start pulling those big pieces off, and they can take that thing, even though it's bent, it's got an adjustment lever on it to where you can allow for the bend in it.
Here's Davey Allison leading this race by 2.3 seconds. Behind him in second place, Mark Martin. Rusty Wallace in a Pontiac, Harry Gant in an old. Kyle Petty's Pontiac. The rest of the top 10, all Chevrolet. We'll be back to the Goodwrench 500 after these messages and Jeff Bodine's thoughts on 1992.
This race at Rockingham will give us more of an indication of what's going to happen this year. This is real racing. This is gut-type racing. You know, slam bang, work hard, 500 laps, 500 miles around this tough one-mile track. If we can survive this, if we can have a good run, if we can win here, that's a pretty good indication we're going to have a good season.
At the North Carolina Motor Speedway, fifth place is about to be in question here. Just as Bill Elliott's car fell well back on that restart, now it's moving back to the front. He's in sixth place, chasing Darrell Waltrip.
And not only that, Mike, a while ago he was right behind Darrell, and going off in the corner, a slow car really clipped him a little bit, and he dropped back about 10 car length, and he's already closed that back up. So he's able to pull back up on Darrell. He can possibly make a pass on him quick.
Remind you of the Gillette Halfway Challenge. Invest 95 cents in a phone call, and they may call you after the halfway point. They'll make one call. And if you know who led the halfway lap, you could win a new Chevy Lumina. Restrictions apply. Read the information on the screen, and there's the number to call. A little further back, here's Brett Bodine with Mike Waltrip and Richard Petty, flexing it on the outside a bit.
I tell you, Richard's having a good run today. He's fighting with everybody. Nobody's getting by him easy, I promise you.
14th place at stake there. And a bit further up, Ernie Irvin was wrestling in a pack that included Dick Trickle and Brett Bodine. There's Sterling Marlin right in with that. And Ricky Rudd tries the low side. Sterling Marlin
drifts up the track. He couldn't stay in the bottom. Kind of drifted up and got right up on the side of Richard there.
You know, that looked like the car just barely moved inside. It felt like it was going around, I guarantee.
Three wide. And Ricky Rudd thought about that one for a second. Did the smart thing. Got out of the middle of that sandwich. It's a pretty good show when you've got a whale of a race for 17th.
These guys are what you get into when you're sitting there racing in this pack of cars. You don't know you're for 17th or 5th.
Yeah.
You get so strung out, and you just got to fight for every position. And not only that, Mike, in a race that runs 500 miles like at this place, one-mile racetrack, you're better to be occupied racing hard than running four hours of racing and sitting there just twiddling your thumbs. It gives you something to do here.
Rick Sachs in the midst of that battle, number 41, the Kellogg's car. And right behind him, Rick Mann. Let's move up to third place, where Rusty Wallace has his hands full with Harry Gant. And reports you that Kyle Petty has lost three spots in about the last six laps here. He has drifted back to eighth place. Two cautions have slowed us. We're close to a record pace. A Harry Gamp working his way to the front.
Look at Harry. He don't care whether they're supposed to run low, high, or where. He's just glad to be on the racetrack somewhere.
That's what he could do last season, just run any place on the racetrack. It looks like he's able to do that. It's just these guys in front of him got a little bit better than they were at the end of the season. They found out some of the things that makes these cars run a little better, and Harry's having to work a little harder than he did at the end of the year.
Harry's never won here. He was in a position to win the race here last fall, but an air wrench misfired on that car on the last pit stop. Dropped him out of contention. In 84, he lost the fall race by 8 inches to Elliott. In 85, Neil Bonnett beat him by 6 inches.
That's as close as I could cut.
Anything for the show, right?
Well, he did get by Rusty, though, and he looks like he's just running anywhere, though. He hasn't really got a set groove. He's just running where he can stay on the racetrack.
Gann and Davey Allison seem to be the two cars that can go just about anywhere they please. High, low, or in the middle. At ninth place, Dale Earnhardt fends off Hut Strickland. And there's Earnhardt's car shooting up the racetrack.
That's an aggravating thing. I guarantee he's biting the side of his face right now. So that's the aggravating thing at Rockingham. You want to run low, you know low's the fastest way, and the car just won't stay down for him.
The only thing he can do right now is run that high line. Let the car go in and take off on its own. Try not to hold it down so much because you bind it up. He's letting the race car drive him around the racetrack now. To get in and fix it where he can aim it where he needs it to go.
That's a long way around.
The other thing, not many cars are running up here, and you wear your tires out quicker because it does not have the rubber that the lower groove has in it.
Well, it'll get some with Earnhardt running up there. Now, here's Kyle Petty, who has drifted back to eighth place. Back behind Bill Elliott, Darrell Waltrip, and Kenny Schrader. Kyle is now eighth. Steve?
You're looking at Robin Pemberton, the crew chief for Kyle Petty. Robin, Kyle has slid back a little bit to eighth place. Anything we should be concerned about?
It's a little too tight right now to run fast. This race is a long race. There's periods in it when you hit it right, and there's other times when you're not.
I noticed that none of the front runners really made any chassis changes, just tires.
Pardon me?
None of the front runners seem to make any chassis changes so far.
I still can't hear you.
Let's go back upstairs, Mike. You heard the question. You can answer it.
Well, it's awful loud down there. We understand, Steve.
Mike, I think one of the key things Robin said is sometimes you hit it, sometimes you don't. If you ever go to a racetrack and see a different complexion of the race, one guy leads for a while, they pit, the next guy comes out and leads, the cast of characters will change all day long. It's the guy that happens to hit it right in that last 100 miles.
Here the battle for ninth. And Hut Strickland is going to the bottom on Dale Earnhardt. Earnhardt's car is still pretty quick, even though it's pushing way up the racetrack this time. Oh, Hut just can't draw off the corner with him.
That particular place here is where there was where the problem happened with Dale and Wiggy. When a car runs high like that, you can drive right. You see the 12 car come up under him, but the 3 car accelerating off the corner. You've got to allow for that guy being out there. It's hard to do.
Well, he's also cutting the line up. Oh, we have an accident on back straightaway.
2 cars.
Bill Parsons and the 0 car.
Dale McCowart. We're under caution for the third time today. There's Dale McCowart out of Savannah, Georgia.
Looks like Bill really got into turn 2 long. Saw him out of the corner right, bouncing up high again over there.
That's Parsons down on the apron in the Harry Melling car. Let's have another look at it.
See if we can pick him up.
Up, he hit Delmer in the back, and
there he goes.
Man, that's a hard lift. He took along for the ride there. There's no steering.
Boy,
on
is that Gant just
that's
making it through?
Yeah,
that's
and then
the
Rusty.
Second, third place coming through.
Here's Elliott on the
and
outside.
Elliott high. And Darrell.
It's hard to tell if they got together. What the deal? If they were together there early coming off the corner. Looked like they were. Then here goes the 9 car right out in the wall. And this is the third and fourth play. Here's Gant coming by on the bottom. Rusty cranking down under him. Now
look at this.
Going to split him. There's Elliott.
He did a little sidestep there. Did you see the back right of Harry Gant's car?
Joey Chitwood couldn't have done any better than
you
that.
Got it.
Leader is on pit road. Steve Evans.
Davey Allison in the pit. The right tires have already been replaced. They swing the jack around. Muscle off the left side tires. He's already got fuel, a clean windshield. No chassis adjustments. Again, we haven't seen any of the front runners touch the chassis. Maybe later on.
He'll lead the race off pit road. Rusty Wallace comes out. Harry Gant, Darrell Waltrip, Dale Earnhardt.
Mike, that was a perfect opportunity right there to see on Davey's car. A lot of times they wonder how they change these tires so quick. If they were paying attention, the left side lug nuts were completely off that car before they ever got the right side's on. The lug nuts are real long, studs are real long, and when they jack the left side up, they just pull it off. They were already waiting on them, so they've got it down to a science.
Let's look at it as Mark Martin saw the incident.
He's right in the middle of the corner.
Delmer just lost it.
Yep.
That's a nice part of a replay.
Here's Mark getting by, and just as this car cleared, I'm sure the zero car backed up in the track right in front of the nine car.
Came right up in front of Phil. Derek Cope on pit road. Long stop for Jeff Bodine. He's getting four tires in the Bud Moore car.
Well, that's what's tough about this race. You prepare and you prepare and you get the best equipment, you get the best game plan, and something like that happened in front of the leaders. You could take out three or four leaders at one time.
I believe Jimmy Spencer may have led that lap. No, he did not. He's a lap down in the Travis Carter car, so it's been Ford all the way today as pit stops continue. 103 laps are complete. Davey Allison's in the front of the field. Rusty Wallace, Harry Gant, Bill Elliott, and Darrell Waltrip. We'll be right back. Well, it just waved the green flag once again, and Davey Allison scoots out with the lead by two car lengths over Rusty Wallace. Harry Gant in third. Bill Elliott in the fourth spot. Then it's a long way back to the fifth place car of Darrell Waltrip in race traffic. He's got Mark Martin with him. There's Davey's view out the back window of Rusty Wallace.
Mike, it seems like, Buddy, like we were talking about earlier, they can stay with Davey for a few laps, and then he gets stronger and stronger. We just saw the two car of Rusty Wallace get a little bit sideways off that corner. He's running as hard as he can. He knows if he can do anything with him, it's got to be early before they get some laps on the tires.
Here's the race for fifth spot. Darrell Waltrip there, Kyle Petty getting underneath Jeff Bodine, and Bodine has gone a lap down. They made a long pit stop under caution. May have been a little too long, but he's gone one lap down. Eight laps in the book, 492 make up today's race. And Davey Allison stretches it out.
Something's happened to Dick Trickle's car going in the third corner, and he slid up high and really stacked up behind him. He's turning down pit road.
And Trickle will pit the Snickers car. Here's Dale Earnhardt. Let's see if they made any improvement on that car. Glenn Jarrett.
Well, guys, the seeming penalty there on Dale Earnhardt was more or less self-inflicted. They came back in to try to make some of those adjustments on the car that Richard Childress had talked about earlier. But just as they got here, the signal for one lap to go came out, so they had to send Dale right back out. So they did not get to make all the adjustments that they wanted to make. He's still fighting an ill-handling race car.
Dick Trickle back on track with four new tires. Had been running in 13th position on the lead lap. Jeff Bodine, we're informed, was lapped under green just prior to the caution flag coming out, so that's why he's a lap down. There's Earnhardt mid-pack, running with Morgan Shepherd and Ted Musgrave. Dale Jarrett's back in the race. Whatever internal engine problems he has have been cured. Napa takes you for a look through the field at the 100 lap mark here at Rockingham. Ted Musgrave is a lap down, but he impresses me. He is quite a chassis engineer and suspension designer in addition to being a very strong race driver.
Real successful in the ASA type racing engineer and been running the Winston Cup stuff and really impressive. They, you know, it's hard to say, you know, they got the best equipment they can get, but you put somebody like him in one of these front running cars and he'll probably get the job done.
Watching the race for second, Rusty Wallace and Bill Elliott.
Bill Elliott's really going down now. He just got by Harry Gant, and he's running right on the back bumper of Rusty Wallace.
Dale Jarrett will return to the garage after one lap.
He's taking those last three pit stops for Elliott to get back virtually in sync where he was early, and see now if he can get up there and get around the two car. Rusty Wallace here, he's got to deal with Davey out front. Nobody's been able to do that yet.
We've been talking about the Chevy versus Ford battle, but it hasn't materialized. The Chevrolet has not led a lap today. At Daytona, Chevrolet led only seven of the 200 laps.
nail that 11 car right to the bottom of the racetrack and just drive by Rusty.
He was nailing a lot of things. He nailed that carburetor and it seemed to do a lot right above that corner.
Up, there goes the Snickers car out. Looks like he has some internal problems with the motor. Good trickle to the garage area.
You're riding with Rusty Wallace. And there's a look at the Stavola car. Hope they had better luck on the ice today than they did here at Rockingham.
You got the big toolbox there, though. They hadn't given up yet.
It's going to take a big toolbox because it's puffing out the tailpipes. They're going to give way inside that one to fix it.
Kerry Hill getting lapped by Davey Allison, who now owns a 1.2-second lead over Bill Elliott.
You know, years ago, you just run in there and snatch that motor out and stick another one in it. Now you got to finish the race with the same block. And these guys will actually pull the block assemblies out and, you know, block assemblies down and put new pistons and stuff in them.
Back at 14th position, that's where you'll find Dale Earnhardt behind Morgan Shepherd. I don't know what it is, but they just don't seem to have really hit it here at this racetrack the last few times they've been here.
I think this is the best I've seen him run since he won the race here in 87 today. But when he hit that back straightaway wall, that took all the handling out of that car until they get to make the adjustments on it.
Mike Walters is ahead of Shepherd. The 12th place car.
You know, Mike, one thing, as Buddy said, when you're right here, when you come up here and test and work on one of these cars, you'll play with that toe end. You'll move it a 16th this way, a 16th that way, a 32nd. And it's real critical on how the car drives. A lick like that in the wall can change it a quarter to a half inch, so they've got to do some cranking on that stuff to fix it.
Let's move back up to the race for 8th spot. That finds Mark Martin in 8th and Ernie Irvin in 9th.
You know, this is a hard race to watch. Everybody's racing out there. It's racing from start to finish, but the fastest car on the racetrack right now, Bill A, is closing in on Davey Allison.
Yeah, just as you say that, buddy, it's down to one, right at 1 second flat. So he is the only guy on the racetrack with a shot to make a run on Davey right now.
You're with Mark Martin inside his car as he sweeps off turn two and down the back straightaway. There's Irvin. And Ernie, I feel, took an unfair share of blame for that Daytona crash. Now, we've seen the replay now about 88 times. But it's the kind of deal where 5 years ago, if there was a wreck within a quarter lap of Jeff Bodine, he got blamed. Now it's Ernie Irvin, and 5 years from now, who knows who it'll be. Ernie, I didn't see that as his fault.
Yeah, Ernie seems to be on the block when something happens. It don't matter what happens, he seems to be there. I didn't see that he did anything. I think they thought Sterling had fallen back a little bit, and they both were going to get back together down the straightaway, he and Bill. And when they closed that hole up, there was the 11, I mean, the McLeod's car right up in the middle, and it just turned them together.
I believe you're right. People were quick to pin it on him because he was there, and I don't feel that was his fault. Right now, 123 laps have been completed. Davey Allison's the race leader. Bill Elliott in 4, the Pontiac of Rusty Wallace, the Olds of Harry Gant, and the Chevrolet of Darrell Walters. Darrell Walters, thoughts on the 1992 season and these messages.
For our team, our team has one goal. Our team has one word. It's nailed in their closets, in the bathrooms, on the walls, in their cars, everywhere we go, and that's championship. This is it for us.
We've been watching a great side-by-side battle for third. Trouble in turn two. Two cars are in it. One looks like Brett Bodine. Morgan Shepherd has a piece of it. And one other car was involved way up near the wall. Caution again, fourth one of the day. Here at lap 129. Jeff Bodine is the other car involved, we're told. And Del McCower. Well, that one happened right between one and two, so something going into the corner. Shepherd will come on around. He will not lose a lap.
We're going to do some work on that right front fender. It's right in against the tire. Boy, they had a great run.
Let's see what happens.
It's Morgan down on the inside.
Down on the flat.
Heath on the flat. He, as far as he can go down, the 26 car cut across.
Him and Brett Bodine get together. Then the 22 looks like gets him in the back of the 15. Now here's the 26 right back up in front of the guys up on the top of the racetrack. And that shows you how good the brakes work on these cars nowadays.
Yeah, John, I don't think Jeff hit anything.
Nope. That's from probably 130, 40 miles an hour to stopping in 50 feet almost.
Bill Elliott. Served by Tim Brewer and Cruz. Junior Johnson.
These guys have been doing it all day long. We talked about earlier, the two cars in and out. They've been really zipping in and out of those pits all day.
Now, Eddie Dickerson and crew doing a great job today for Rusty. Davey Allison coming out first. Hey, Wallace is pitted way up near the start-finish line, and Davey's pitted well down for turn one. So even though Rusty's stops appear to be faster, Davey gets down pit lane and back out into action ahead of him. The King will get four tires.
At the top of the show, we were showing getting ready in the pits down there, and there were 16 sets of tires. These guys have got anywhere from 10 to 16 sets of tires ready. This place uses them up.
Now, as we had that caution flag, there was also this incident, Morgan Shepherd coming up.
Get out of the way, Delmer, he said.
This was how Morgan was trying to get back up to speed and recover from the incident in turn one. He and Delmer Coward got together a bit.
We talked about the 21 car having the fender down on the tire. He probably did that back in the middle of the corner, and he might not have been able to turn the car well on.
He's in for four tires right now, Shepherd is.
Usually, if you're going to run into the guy, you do it in the corner. You don't do it down the straightaway. There had to be something wrong.
Well, while we're under caution, why don't we take a break from the North Carolina Motor Speedway. Davey Allison is the race leader. Rusty Wallace is second. And report of a brake problem on the Dale Earnhardt car. We'll check on that when we come back to the North Carolina Motor Speedway. And the Goodwrench 500, 131 laps down. Green flag is just waved, and this restart does not include the three car of Dale Earnhardt. He is on pit road, and Glenn Jarrett moving into position there.
Well, they have evidently now, they think they've got part of the problem cured. They've got they're putting the hood back down on the car. But this number three car of Dale Earnhardt doesn't look like he's going to get back in the action anytime soon. I think they're going to have to take the car behind the wall. NASCAR pitchers are right on top of the situation. The crew chief, Kurt Schermerdine, is asking for some tools there. And they are indeed working on that caliper on the brake system. So now the hood goes back up. This is going to be a lengthy stay, and if it's much longer, the official's going to have to pull the car behind the wall. But it's going to be awfully tough for him to get back into it. He's one lap down now, and the car's coming down the front straightaway down to put him another two laps down. So it's going to be a while yet.
Steam or smoke coming from that right front wheel. That car sits on pit road, and we go back up front where Harry Gantz has moved under Jeff Bodine and chasing Rusty Wallace, the second place car. Jeff Bodine caught up in, but didn't hit anything in that incident in turn one. Still one lap off the pace. Back at eighth place, Darrell Waltrip. There with Ken Schrader. Now they're trying to pinch off the line to the left front brake on Earnhardt's car, so essentially he'll have brakes on three wheels.
Yeah, Mike, when they do that, they've had a problem with one of the calipers blowing an O-ring or something. The only thing to do is they just virtually beat the line flat and then use three-wheel brakes the rest of the day.
There's Waltrip and Schrader, once teammates in the Hendricks table. And there's bigger little brother, Mikey Waltrip.
Big little brother.
Yep. Coming along. We'll take you up to fourth place, where Hutch Strickland is holding off Bill Elliott. And Kyle Petty right back at it. Fourth, fifth, and sixth.
You know, they told us earlier that Kyle's car was a little bit tight, and they've had an opportunity to work on it now, and they might have the thing a little bit better now. The black flag in one car down here, it's the number 66 car.
Chad Little, the Cale Yarborough car. Work continues on pit road on Earnhardt. As we follow this battle, Kyle's going to slip up there in front of the Allison car with Hutch Strickland aboard as they lap past Jimmy Spencer. second eight spot. Schrader with Walter. Kenny Schrader's made the pass. And now here comes Mike Walter. Underneath Darrell. Chuck Ryder's Pennzoil car up a notch. That moves Darrell back to ninth. Check that 10. Up front, Davey Allison, Rusty Wallace in second. Harry Gant third, Bill Elliott fourth. Fifth is Kyle Petty. Sixth, Hunt Strickland. Seventh, Ernie Irvin. As we ride with Mark Martin. Glenn Jarrett.
Well, we're still in Dale Earnhardt's pits, and now the technical inspector, Gary Nelson, has come by. There's brake fluid has sprayed all over the right front wheel of the car. We still don't know what wrong. I'm standing here with Richard Childress. He's talking to Dale Earnhardt right now. But NASCAR is awfully concerned about this. He's been on pit road an awfully long time. He has fired the car now, getting ready to take off. Let me see if I can get a word with Richard Childress here. Richard, can you give us an update there? What's going on?
We just had a problem when we got in that wreck. Something happened and it broke something on the left front.
What was the problem on the right front?
Bent the brakes up on the left front.
Okay, he said it just when they got in that little wreck there, it did indeed mess that O-ring up. Then it blew the fluid out on the right side. I guess the extra pressure from having to shut that left side off.
We talked to Gary Nelson before the first of the show. Not only is he policing things better, whenever there used to be days that when you had this problem, you could actually go back on that racetrack without brakes and race. But now that was Gary Nelson standing there personally to make sure that car was in condition to go back on the racetrack.
I wonder if he's just got rear wheel brakes right now. If he does, that's a miserable thing to try to get along with.
Well, he is 10 laps down. He's just going to have to ride this one out.
Yeah, there's brake adjusters. When Buddy talks about rear brakes being miserable, not only from the stopping standpoint, but there's adjusters to put more front or rear brakes on the car to have different handling characteristics. Boy, that thing is a handful of drive with nothing but rear brakes.
You're watching the battle for third where Bill Elliott has just overtaken Harry Gant for third spot. Which of these drivers will lead the halfway lap? To enter the Gillette Halfway Challenge, you can call the 900 number that's on your screen. 95 cents per call. After the halfway mark, Gillette will call one lucky race fan. If it's you and you know who led the halfway lap, you can win a Chevy Lumina. Now Elliott's pulling right away from Gant once again.
You know, Elliott, a while ago, the longer they ran, might be something they've got with these boys if the things continue to run good like this. But a while ago, he was able to wind the two car in and pass him and work on Davey a little bit. It's taking him a little while to get back there now.
First to second, 3.6 seconds. Back to Bill Elliott. Here comes Schrader and Mike Walter trying to march their way up through the field. They're in eighth and ninth place, respectively. And Donald Coward's lap car.
It's a narrow place up off two. They ran up on that lap car, and Mike Walter had to really get over in line to get through there. You can't go past them on two side by side of that particular part of the track.
147 laps complete, Steve.
You know, yesterday in the Busch Grand National Race, all of the incidents, well, most of them, were up in turn number two. It looked like a train wreck by the end of the day. And here today, Buddy, Neil, the same situation. Everything seems to happen in turn number two. Exactly why is turn two the Bermuda Triangle of NASCAR?
Well, let's ask Professor Baker, since he teaches people how to race on this track.
Well, most people don't realize that turn has a little crown in it. And as you start off the corner, it'll unload the car towards the wall, right in the middle part of coming out of two. And it just throws the car right against the wall. So you really have to watch yourself over there.
Davey said an interesting thing. He was coaching Jeff Gordon a bit. He says, if you got your car set up to come off the bottom of the corner, if you have to lap somebody and you have to come off the top side of the corner, the car won't work at all. It's just, it works so different.
Yeah. You're coming down there in driving school soon, and then you'll find out that if you come off that corner wrong, it's virtually impossible not to knock that wall down. So you really have to come off there and give the car allowance to let it move a little.
I think one thing that hurts you in that thing, too, the only way to keep hitting that wall is to roll out the throttle at that particular part of the track. And you, how many times have we seen a guy roll out of the throttle a bit and somebody nails him in the rear?
Yeah.
So it's almost a catch-22. If you don't lift, you hit the wall. If you do, somebody drives you in the wall. So that's really a tough place on the racetrack.
Let's pick up the battle for second here, Rusty Wallace and Bill Elliott. Bill has driven away from Harry Gant. And it's closing up on the second place car.
Bill Elliott's running a completely different groove from anybody out there right now. He goes in the bottom part of the racetrack and goes nearly, watch him go up right here. And then he'll drop back down and make that shot off the corner. But he's running a different groove from anybody out there right now.
In the middle of the corner, buddy, he's a full lane wider than anyone else, but he's got it working for him.
Looks like he's on a short track where he's kind of diamonding that end of the racetrack.
Just one and two, though. He's running three and four like everybody else right around the bottom, but he's getting through one and two really well, letting the car go up the racetrack.
Sixth place will pick up Hunt Strickland in sixth, Ernie Irvin in seventh. Jeff Bodine's running with them, but one lap down in 21st place. Meanwhile, back at second spot, Elliott has caught Rusty Wallace. There's Kyle Petty in the picture. He's the fifth place car. 153 laps. Here's how they're running. Allison and Wallace up front. Elliott Gant, Kyle Petty. Rest of the top 10 back through Darrell Waltrip. We'll be back to Rockingham after these messages and Ernie Irvin's outlook on 1992.
For us, I think it's going to be a good season. You know, it didn't start off well, but, the car ran well everywhere we went last year, and teams matured another year, and I really look for this Kodak Film Duck or every team to just mature a lot and, be contention every week.
Kyle Petty is beginning to back up in the field. Hunt Strickland went past him into fifth place. Then Ernie Irvin took over the sixth spot, and there's Kyle at seventh place. Meanwhile, Davey Allison's opened up a 5-second lead on the new second-place car, Bill Elliott. You see Kyle beginning to drift back even further.
Yeah, we've noticed, and he's dropping back a little faster than he has been during the race. I don't know whether they might have went too far with their adjustments.
Buddy, just as you said that, if it went too far, they were talking about a push condition, and off that particular corner right there, we saw him have to tail the car out. So sometimes you'll overreact and change the thing a little bit too much. But now the next stop, they go back halfway in between the two changes, and maybe they'll hit on it.
Well, let's find out. Steve Evans?
Well, first of all, meet Felix Sabatis. Felix, you know what's going on with the car while he's sliding backwards a bit?
Yeah, we have a little bit of a push going to the corners, loose coming off. We hope for a long caution flag so we can fix it.
You know, every year you're a story here yourself. 2 years ago, you gave Kyle a Rolls Royce when he won. Last year, it was a ski boat for the crew. What have we got up our sleeper this season with Kyle?
Well, if we win today, the crew is going to split $190,000.
Yeah, and then there's a big bonuses for Kyle along the way.
Well, there's a bonus for Kyle at the end of the year, it's for $5 million. And this is one of the races that we'll count toward a $5 million bonus.
Do you need any help?
Right now, we need a lot of help.
I want to apply to work for Sabatis Racing, guys.
Buddy just fainted.
You know, we're joking about that, but Felix has got several incentives that Kyle can win $1 million for winning Charlotte, $1 million for Talladega, $1 million for the points. There's $6 million up for grabs, and it's realistic that it could happen. They've got that type of race team.
Gonna need to improve on the way he's running right this moment, though. Mike Waltrip is moving in on Kyle Petty. Seventh place at stake here. Meanwhile, up front, Davey Allison trying to become the first driver to win the first two races of the season since when? We'll tell you in a minute. We'll watch Kyle Petty and Mike Walton battle along for seventh place.
And while these guys are battling along, Bill Elliott is finally winding in Davey Allison just a little bit.
Now you see Elliott on the left of your screen has moved away from Rusty Wallace just a bit. Davey Allison's lead is diminishing. In Rusty's view of Bill Elliott. 3.8 seconds for the second. Last driver to win the first two races of the season drove for the Wood Brothers. The guy sitting to my left won the second two races of the season for Ramach a few years ago, Neil Bonnet, but that's not the answer. Here's Mike Waltrip moving in. Seventh place again is at stake.
You can see right there, you're talking about Kyle's car pushing the middle and loose off. If you've got a car that's doing one or the other, it's easier to fix. When you got one doing both of those, pushing and loose, you got your work cut out for you. And that's the reason they said they need a caution. They might have to put a rubber in a spring or make some major change.
A lot of times that'll be too much bite in the car, though. It'll let it take off in the corner, push it, and then it'll unload in the center of the corner and make it loose coming off.
Is there anything worse than being pushing going in and loose coming out?
Yeah.
Coming out?
Not coming out.
Not making the curve.
Right. In 1976, David Pearson drove the Wood Brothers car to victory at Riverside, California, then the first race of the season, then he won Daytona. It was Mike Waltrip and Kyle Petty continuing to run at 7th and 8th spot.
Yeah, good indication of what we're talking about, really dropping back.
And here, 12th place, up for grabs, Ricky Rudd. Took it away a lap ago from Sterling Marlin.
Yeah, I'm sure they qualified way back in the pack. Sterling qualified way back, and after Daytona, they really came in here and needed to get a good race down. And they've been working hard today, been improving a little bit at a time.
That's 12th place. 20 cars on the lead lap all the way back to Rick Mann. Ninth place coming up here. You see Kenny Schrader and Mark Martin running for ninth spot. Now they're just a bit behind Kyle Petty and ahead of Darrell Waltrip. Martin's view of Schrader.
Leaning over, getting a little bit of air in the grill, trying to cool it down a little bit. It's a good view of what's going on here. That's a lot of banking. They're dealing 25 or 30 degrees of banking and letting him show up when you're on there. Mark taking a look to the inside. A lot of times they do that mic, and he said, well, you're really not trying to pass, but it's a pretty warm day. They run these cars as plugged up on the nose as they can for speed, and you stick it over the right or left somewhere. There's Schrader waving, you know.
What's he waving?
He's either saying, there he went. He told him he could have the inside line.
Yeah.
That's the case right there. He said, well, you know, maybe we run better with you in the front. So Kenny reached over, motioned inside, pulled over, let it go by.
That was the one thing about you, Neil. We raced together as many years as we raced together. If I caught you and you knew that I was a little bit faster, up to about 10 laps to go, you worked with every driver out there. But 10 laps to go, you were mean then.
That's the way it's supposed to be, but that was a real good indication these guys do work with each other and talk back and forth between cars. Now, the last 10 laps, you don't understand what they're talking about because it might not be real nice, but this point of the race, they're willing to give and take a little bit.
Now, in this case, it didn't pay off for Schrader because Martin has gone off and left him just a bit. But the next time, it might be Schrader with a faster car, and he'll need a favor.
Yeah, Mike, it might not look like it paid off, but whenever the car Mark Martin was up under Kenny, he's probably really having his hands full, being loose, and he'd rather just get him out from under him, let him go on.
Schrader finished second here last year to Kyle Petty, but right now they're all chasing Davey Allison. Bill Elliott in second, both in fourth.
Seems like this has been the name of the game for quite a while, Chase Davey Allison. The end of last season, and this year started off the same way. They've got one heck of a race team going right now.
There's Allison's line down into turn one. Working right on the bottom of the racetrack, short way around.
Look how smooth that car is. It don't have a vibration in it. You can see the wind in that in the mirror there. That's the only thing that's moving in that whole car in Davey's head a little bit.
Got a throttle up and down. We joke about it, but I'm telling you, Robert Yates has really got that thing. A lot of power on the ground. I say a lot of power. Larry McReynolds put it on the ground, and Davey's really been selective how he uses it.
Let's watch Harry Gant for a bit here. He's the fourth place car. And old High Groove Harry is living up to his old nickname here.
Mike, you know, just like Buddy was talking a while ago, Bill Elliott, boy, here's a car that almost lost it coming off the two and got headed to the infield.
Mike Skinner. You were saying?
I forgot what I was saying. I almost spun out. But, you know, earlier Buddy was talking about Bill Elliott trying to high line and really pick up a lot of time. Well, there's spotters for every one of these race teams. They call, hey, guys, somebody's really kicking your rear by running high. How about jumping up there and trying that? And they'll give their lap times. If it's quicker, they'll tell you, and they'll make you stay up there.
They say that up at Dover Downs, where we'll be the first part of June, Dennis McGlynn can't sell any advertising on the outside of the wall because every race Harry Gant comes around, scrapes it all off.
If you notice, Harry Gant's really reeling in Rusty Wallace now by using that line. Watch him when he goes off in the corner there. He'll gain a bunch on him.
He's got a big piece of paper stuck on the grill area right there. That doesn't look like much, but these cars are really confined on how much air they're taking in. He's got about half of his grill area plugged up right now.
Third and fourth place from Rusty Wallace's car. The round flat piece you see in the lower right corner, that's the antenna for the in-car camera, and that big tube.
That big tube, Mike, is a guide to take the jack wrench down inside the car to turn this jack screw to change the weight on the car. It's simply a sleeve to lead it down to turn on the lift or spring.
Alan Kulwicki is back in the race. Kulwicki completed 51 laps before being involved in that altercation with Earnhardt on the back straightaway. He's coming back out to run for points. He's fourth in the point standings coming in here.
While we're talking about points, there was Dale Jarrett, like you mentioned earlier. He's out riding around inside the track.
You know, that little piece of paper there, I'm going to go back to that. That thing is really a serious problem on Oldsmobile, because it's got two small holes on the top part, and they usually close off the bottom part and weather the spool like this, so that's the only air intake he has.
You folks may not think of that when you let that chicken wrapper go in the grandstand or that napkin, but could cost your favorite driver the race. That's some just piece of debris that blew around and wound up right on that grill. Yeah, at least it's not a seagull.
Mike, we can see right here, see the bottom area right above where it says Oldsmobile? That's covered up with tape. They completely taped that area up because it was a fairly cool day, but now the tape is on the bottom, and that particular piece of paper has got the only functional part of the radiator open and plugged up, but hopefully it won't hurt anything.
They are lucky in one respect, though. Harry Gantz drove a race car for many a day now, and he knows what works and what don't work, and he watches his gauges.
He used to call me when the motor blew up, and they say, what were the gauges saying just before it blew up? I said, boy, it was perfect. I always waited until it blew up, and I looked to see what the problem was.
Don't they run best just before they grenade?
Yeah, when they really get to going, you better tighten the belts up, because something's fixing to happen.
Loosen it up. From Rusty Wallace's car, looking at Harry Gantz. Third and fourth place. Allison leads it, Elliott second.
After Rusty Wallace watches this tape, I bet you they put some more bracing on that rear window, unless they want that window to come down for some reason.
I can't imagine that.
Because the rear window bulging out a little bit puts some more air on that black spoiler that we're seeing back there. When it concaves like that, there's a chance it could hurt the spoiler effect.
Wallace on the low side, Dale Jarrett back to the garage.
Buddy, unless they learn something in the wind tunnel, they like it caving in.
Yeah, exactly. No, I can't see where that would be any benefit at all there.
No, I think that would create turbulence.
Yeah. Look at Harry up there. He's up there in uncharted waters running around the top.
Well, we'll see if we can get Gann a new compass here when we come back. 183 laps on the board. Davey Allison and Bill Elliott in fours out in front. 2.4 seconds, first to second. We'll be right back. Just as this man, Davey Allison, was coming up on Rick Mast and Richard Petty to put them a lap down, there was trouble at the other end of the racetrack. Derek Cope spun up into the wall in turn two. Mast and Petty stayed on the lead lap and were under caution once again. Fifth one of the day. Rusty Wallace getting service.
Had a problem with the lug wrench right there. The right front guy had a problem. Called the jack man back around. We've been bragging all day about Rusty Wallace getting in and out, and they're having to redo the right front wheel.
Now they're back around on the left side. Meanwhile, Davey Allison gets done, and Dale Earnhardt comes in behind the wall. So Wallace will be toward the back of the lead lap.
You know, Neil, that didn't look too important right there. You say they're under the yellow, he didn't lose much, but that track position, he has lost a bunch of real estate here that's going to be hard to make up.
Yeah, buddy, on the same vein, we were talking about Elliott, such a force early, and it's taken him three cautions and about 100 laps to get back to where he was in second place. There's Earnhardt's car down there. They're probably going to have to put some brakes back on that thing. It looks like they got it up on four jack stands, and they can actually run a new brake line to the one that was bad.
Let's look and see why we're under caution. There's the leader, Davey Allison, coming up on the outside, right where Derek Cope is.
Look at the king here. I'm glad. I know he's glad he turned back up the bank. He looked like he's going to come down.
Something that sometimes creates that. They were probably telling Derek Cope, here comes Davey to lap you. And when you get that call, a lot of times you'll try to pick the pace on up, not get lapped. And looked like he sailed her down in one a little bit hard and broke loose, and he backed her up in the wall.
Steve Evans.
We're down with Dale Earnhardt, the number three car, and by actual count, there are 14 uniform crewmen working on this car. The brakes are still the main problem, but while the car is in here, they're also checking everything else out, the rear brakes, anything on the car that might need attention. No one is not busy on this crew.
New caliper on the right front. Looks like they may have done some work with that hub as well. As the Childress crew.
Looks like they're going
to get Earnhardt back.
You know, Mike, it looks like they're spinning the caliper off of there. They're just taking, I don't know what they're doing, if they're putting a new brake line in or what, but they've got major surgery going on.
Now, here's Davey Allison. And just to show you what happened there to Rusty Wallace on that pit stop, we'll kind of drift back through that field. There's Allison up front, and Bill Elliott is right with him behind the safety car. We are going to go back to green this time. Napa field update coming in just a bit here. There's Allison up front. Bill Elliott lined up right behind him. Then it'll be Harry Gant, Mike Waltrip, Hut Strickland, Mark Martin, then Ernie Irvin, Kenny Schrader, Darrell Waltrip, 10th Ricky Rudd, 11th will now be Brett Bodine and Rusty Wallace way back in 12th. Cost your Napa race update.
Cost him 10 or 12 positions. That one little bitty fall to deal with that wrench, but he's got a long time to get it back.
What you're seeing is how they were running just prior to this caution flag. Coming slow off turn four, still no flag, still not, and now we get the green.
Looks like Davey started them in first gear that time.
We had a restart like that yesterday that stacked them up six wide in the Busch Grand National Good Wrench 200. If you missed it live here on TNN, be sure you catch one of the replays. It was a barn burner with Ward Burton winning his first Busch Grand National victory. Richard Petty soldiering along. Got a reprieve right there. He's in 16th spot, still on the lead lap. Kyle right behind him. Sterling Marlin there.
Here's Elliott's first chance since the early in the race to have a chance to take the lead. And he's been working. He's had to work his way all the way back to Davey every time. He's sitting on his rear bumper now. Trying to see if he's got enough to handle, buddy.
I think he's got enough. He looks a little bit quicker than Davey, right? But like you said, Davey gets stronger as they go.
Of the 192 laps we've run here so far, Fords have led 154 of them. Pontiac's been in front for 38 laps. Oldsmobile and Chevrolet shut out of the front spot. Alan Kulwicki back in the race after a lengthy stop. More front end repairs on his car.
We've noticed since the start of this restart, Elliott has stayed in the bottom the entire time. While it's always quick lines of high through one and two, he might try that in a minute. In a minute, how about this lap?
He said, I'm not getting it done down here. Maybe I need to go back up high. I think he made a lot, may have lost a little bit of time there, though.
What has Davey Allison got?
He's got a lot of race car, a lot of talent, a lot of power, and it's all coming together
and
right now.
Super proof. You know who's been coming out of the pits first every time, don't you? Davey Allison. That's just a team that wants to win, believes they can win, and they normally do. Yellow flag.
Trouble off turn two again. One car has come down the pit lane on the back straightaway. I believe that's a result of something that happened back there. That'll put us under caution. It's debris on the track. Jacques Debris, the famous French driver.
Well, I saw a car look like he spun and went down pit road wide open.
No, that was Ed Faree. That was yesterday.
No, Stan Smith. Something happened to him. I've seen him all over the place over there.
The Ameritron batteries car.
If they spin, they're going to have to stay on the racetrack so we can keep up with the spinning. Going down the pits kind of loses us.
That's the back straightaway pit lane back where Stanley Smith was. He will come to the pits this time. Davey Allison may come in. Let's see. Pit lane is open. But again, here's where track position is so important. None of these leaders are coming in, and we get a one to go. In fact, pit lane is empty.
There's Jeff Bodine down on the inside. He'll be able to pull up beside Davey Allison on this restart. He's really wanting to get that lap back, but when somebody's as strong as Davey's car, it's hard to get a lap back any way you do it.
The cars one lap down are Jeff Bodine and Bobby Hamilton.
I don't know why, but it looked like Bodine motioned Bobby Hamilton around him. But now it looks like he decided to go back up there himself.
Two laps back, Ted Musgrave. Three laps down, Chad Little.
There's Bobby Hamilton right there. See, Jeff Bodine has decided to get back around in front of him so he'd have that preferred start on the front.
He might have had a friend he wanted to wave at back there.
They put the yellow light back on top of the caution car, so it won't be a restart this end.
Well, we're not going back to green, so we'll take this break at 198 laps. Davey Allison leads it. There's your top five. And we'll see how sixth place Mark Martin looks to 1992 and these messages.
We have a better understanding today than we've ever had of what we want in our race car and out of our race car, and what to expect and what is too much to expect, and how to keep working on our stuff to make it better.
They just restarted the Goodrich 500, and the man on the move is Mike Waltrip. Got himself a great restart, and he's broken free of that second pack. Up front, though, Bill Elliott chasing Davey Allison. Harry Gant in third. The lap car of Jeff Bodine. There's Mike Waltrip, the yellow car, leading that second pack. Dale Earnhardt back in the race. But he is some 11, make that 21 laps down.
Mike, when they take off, just like on the restart going up through the gear, Fort Davey just drove away from him. It takes Elliott a little while to get it wound up, but he's all over him now.
In third place, Harry Gant. Goal car. Here's Earnhardt. Got himself a brake job behind pit lane. And he's back out there, but way back in 33rd place. Only four cars out of this race. Dick Trickle, water pump trouble. Johnny McFadden parked his car. So did Andy Belmont and Dave Marcus with engine trouble. First to second for Carling.
Every time Elliott tries that outside move, like Buddy talked about earlier, he loses a little bit of ground. Looks like the only way he's going to be able to pull it off is maybe get Davey up and get under him some way.
I think on new tires, he has to stay low, and if the tires get worn down a little bit, the higher groove works a little better. But right now, every time he goes up, he loses three or four car lengths.
Mike Waltrip's going to be a player in this. He just moved past Jeff Bodine. And there is Mark Martin. Moving up on fifth place, Hutch Strickland. Hutch had a good run here today.
Yeah, I wouldn't mind seeing some of these guys win a race so they get out of that Wimpton Open that I got to run in.
You'll see that on TNN, the Wimpton Open and the Wimpton. Stock Car Racing's all-star event in May. And trouble on Dale Jarrett. Once again. Up front, though, Dale Jarrett's in black flag. That's the reason. And here comes Elliott storming back.
You know, we said he almost have to try him on the inside. Right now, Bill's going to stick the nose of that thing just as far up in the back of that other car as he can and see if he can loosen Davey up a little bit so he has that inside line. See how close he gets it. You know, the ideal thing here is to see how close you can and see if you can loosen him up and take that inside line away.
Right here is a good place to loosen him.
Or maybe the Ford drivers on orders not to mess with each other too bad and do, you know, till the late stages of the event.
The matter might be they might be on orders, but who listens?
Yeah,
we're racing, you know, it's every man for himself, I would think.
Also, when you see that view out the back window of Davey's car, note the bracing that they use compared to the Rusty Wallace car, and that back window doesn't flex a bit.
No. I tell you, you just said something. There's no such thing as a motor company telling this guy not to race another guy hard. These are individually owned teams, even though they raced before. And they want to be leading this race.
Right. And pretty soon, one of them's going to get $10,000.
You know, Mike, we kind of joked about it. It's kind of like the guy that Wilson building the football for the Super Bowl. They don't
right.
tell him how to kick it and where to throw it.
Uh-uh.
They just furnish equipment. You go racing with it.
There's the 900 number to call and register for the Gillette Halfway Challenge. And if you're called and know who wins the halfway bonus among these drivers, you could be driving a new Chevy Lumina.
I tell you, they're really after the points today. I just seen Phil Parsons come by here, and he's been out for a week and a half.
97 laps, to be exact.
It's going to be 98 this time by. Putting another lap down.
We've run 408 laps of Winston Cup racing in 1992. Davey Allison has led about two-thirds of them, 274, have seen that black car in front.
He sure is a greedy little thing, isn't he, when they give him something to work with? That's the way you're supposed to be.
The last Ford winner of this event, Davey's dad.
You know,
speaking of great,
you just said
there's one.
You just said something funny. When they first start racing, it's Bobby Allison's son, Davey.
Right, now he's Davey's dad. You want to tell that story on Buck?
No. Let's don't say anything about my dad. He'll ring your chop.
That's right.
You know, just a few laps ago, we saw Bill all over Davey, and they came up on one lap car. That one lap car gave him a 10-lap separation. So critical on this racetrack, getting a clear run through all the way around.
Allison, the leader. We're about 35 laps from halfway. That comes at lap 246. 211 on the board. Let's go back to 8th place. Ken Schrader and Darrell Walker go at it. This is back behind Mark Martin and Ernie Irvin, the yellow car. Schrader, who finished second here last year. And Darrell. Ricky Rudd behind them and Rusty Wallace. Going around Del McCoward's lap car, zero. Schrader and Walker. Now, we haven't seen Rusty Wallace, remember. They had that misfire on the air wrench on pit road, and he took the restart green flag back in 12th place, and that's where he is. Let's go up to 4th place, where Mike Waltrip has now been reeled in by Hut Strickland and Mark Martin.
I tell you, Hut's having a tremendous run today. I believe if he ever gets up there right on the leader, I think he'll be able to run with him. You see Rusty now. He dropped back to 12th. That's all he can do. When he's in second, he can maintain his position. It's tough to come from the back to the front.
Let's listen and ride along with Mark Martin here for a lap.
Yeah, you feel like you can just stand wide open in the gas at that particular part of the racetrack, but it's kind of like that guy going off that ski jump. If you once you make that commitment off the end, there's no backing up. And when you stand in the gas too soon, you're going to bounce off that wall.
You know, it works great for Mark, but I don't believe I've ever seen anybody hold a steering wheel in that position. He's got both hands together.
They used to always tell me 12 and 3 and 1 and 4. I used to grab that thing anywhere I could get a hold of it and try to survive.
Riding along with Mark Martin, the Jack Roush car, Valvoline Ford. They're right with him, there Mike Walter. Now Walter's gone to the back of that tussle. Ernie Irvin behind him. Ran real well on new tires, but now he's drifted back a bit. Martin now coming up on Hut Strickland.
You know, Buddy mentioned earlier that Jack Roush doesn't mind turning a lot of RPM in a car. And, you know, they sat down before the race, they said, well, we'll give you this gear, but you've got to take care of it all day long. You've got to keep in mind that thing is there. You just hold that throttle open a little too long, work it too hard, and it might not run very long. You've got to wait till the end or something. He possibly got a little more race car he's using right now. They'll just wait till later on to be able to abuse it some more.
I tell you what, Jack Roush sets the timing more than I've ever turned on a racetrack. I have never heard a man that just really ripped one up.
Roush's other car, driven by Wally Dahlenbeck, running 25th right now. Former Trans Am champ. Article in Car and Driver magazine. Jack Roush said, he said, when I'm happy is when I'm sitting in my office listening to an engine run on the dyno.
Oh, yeah, that open. Cash register going ching.
You bet.
I tell you, the accomplishments, you know, just like the 24-hour race, they win that thing every year. You know, they got a lot of reliability in this stuff. But I'm telling you, he doesn't mind stepping over an uncharted ground and see what it takes, how much you can abuse this stuff. It's like Fred's getting a little bit loose up off the corner there.
Here's a battle back in the field now. Of these three cars, only Richard Petty is on the lead lap. Chad Little is three laps off the pace, and Earnhardt is way back. 21 car, Greg Saxon, the lead line.
Dale's in a very confusing thing right now. He's many laps back and everything, but he still wants to race. That's a long race if you don't have somebody to race with, so he's going to let her rip.
You know, you said, buddy, it's kind of hard to take a thoroughbred making pace. And the problem they got now, they're so far down, but he's got brakes in all the car. And at the end of this race, the more people fall out, he can pick up some points.
Richard Petty's run extremely well today. I'm real proud of him. He's been in the fray all day.
Earnhardt is 22 laps down, but remember, we're not even halfway. And some of the races we've had here, he could be in the top 15 before it's over. Presently 31st.
Kowicki back out running.
Here's and Mark takes you inside of Hunt Strickland. And Mark will move up into the fourth position. 222 laps complete. We'll be back after this. TNN Motorsports exclusive live coverage of the Goodrich 500 is brought to you by Haviland Formula 3 Motor Oil. Add more life to your car. Well, they've added a lot of life to Davey Allison's car. He is flying. Back to turn one with 229 laps down.
We're beginning to see Bill Elliott in the front, same frame now, so he's closing it in a little bit, but we saw that before. We saw him able to close in, but we never did see the pass. And once he gets there, he's got his work cut out for him again. If he can get there.
Car's just right on the bottom of the racetrack and just rocks steady.
Yeah. Yeah. The lead car always looks better than everything else out there, believe me.
It always feels pretty good, too, doesn't it, buddy?
Yeah. There's my little brother,
Randy Baker.
Little brother, how big is he? What's he weigh? Y'all don't have any little family members that I can count.
Well, we're coming up on halfway, and Davey Allison right now looks poised for that $10,000 bonus. Some of the drivers we talked to had thoughts about that.
Halfway through, I'm going to get that $10,000 halfway money as I cross that start finish line.
You hope at the halfway point you can say, well, it hasn't been that bad yet.
If we're in a position at that point or getting to that point that we may have a shot at it, yeah, we'll gamble a little bit, maybe stretch the fuel or whatever we might have to do to get it. But we're not going to let that dictate what we're going to do all day.
I learned a lesson the hard way. It's a whole lot better to lead that last lap than it is the halfway point.
But he wouldn't mind the $10,000, I'm sure.
I doubt, seriously, if you'll see him back off and let somebody else lead it. He's worried about the last one, but I bet you'll try to cash that check at halfway, too.
Greg Sachs' car is in trouble. He's dropped down to the apron here in the front straightaway. Like the cornflakes got soggy.
Oh. Smoke coming out of the back up there having some kind of problem. And there's a gentleman that's not having a whole lot of problems.
Nope. .232, 10 laps from halfway.
Here comes Phil. Junior said, go on up there and get that money, son.
Yeah, now he'll, Junior will remind you about that $10,000 plan. I promise you, he's told me a time or two, and looks like they're going to pop the whip on the Budweiser car and see if he can get up here and take some of that money.
Here he comes. Chad Little had just overlapped in the Phillip 66 car.
Pretty impressive here. I mean, he is closing in fast, too.
Looked like Davey hung the rear out just a little bit off that corner. The first time I've seen that car the least bit out of line all day long. But while he was hanging it out, he was moving on out on it, too.
Greg Sachs put Kellogg back in the cupboard for the day. He's in the garage. Third place. Harry Gant, Mark Martin. Battling there for third. Hunt Strickland's the fifth place car. Here's Steve Evans.
Well, there you see the main man behind Mark Martin's automobile, carman Jack Roush. He told me just a few moments ago they got behind on the chassis set up early on in the race. But in the last pit stop, they made some changes. He said Mark is not talking on the radio at all. And something's wrong with the car. Mark turns into a real chatterbox. Roush says the car must be perfect, and they are taking it easy. As you guys guessed up there. Mark is pacing himself, hoping the car's in front of him, starts to fall off. He's got a lot left.
Running fourth right now, Cactus Jack Roush, car owner. part of a very famous drag racing team in the 60s, early 70s. Wayne Gap, Jack Roush, won a lot of drag races. Steve can tell you about that. A lot better than I can.
We're right on around again.
There goes Mark Martin. He's got a drag race motor in that thing today. Running well. Closing in on halfway, six laps to the halfway point. If you've called the Gillette folks, this would be a bad time to go to the refrigerator. Could be Davey Allison, it could be Bill Elliott. And here they come up on Richard Petty and Bobby Hamilton.
And this traffic might be one thing that determines who leads halfway. Get hung up in this traffic. Here's Bill looking one side or the other. Davey's got to make up his mind inside or outside of these lap cars. Goes outside of Petty. There's Richard down on the inside.
And they'll put this track's all-time winner one lap down. Now Bobby Richard. Hamilton.
There's Richard with a hot dog wrapper on his hood.
Must be a Gualdon. They're part of that fan appreciation deal. Probably stopped to get it as he went by the backstretch stand. Kyle Petty now, who started on the pole, only 6 seconds away from being lapped himself by these two. And Bill's going to make a run at him for that $10,000, isn't he?
He's got the inside line. Can he get out in the corner under Davey? Davey out handling down that straightaway.
I tell you what, though, Bill has a stronger car off the corner, it looks like, coming up out of four. He had him pretty good coming up through there.
Three more laps.
When we were talking about people willing to pull gears, Junior reaching that truck, too, and slam one in the rear of that car, then make it hop off that corner.
Ooh, he's getting in the corner pretty decent, too.
Two laps to halfway. Check that. We just altered that scoreboard. Let's make that six laps to halfway. My mistake.
The racing got so good they decided to back the scoreboard up
a
bit here. Make it run for a while.
At least they did. .246 will be the halfway point. Delma Cowart has gone to the garage.
Bill might have used up what he had. You know, he laid back and laid back, and he made that real serious run on Davey, and he didn't get by. Now we got to see if Davey's got enough to get away from him.
Lapping fast, Bill Parsons, 97 laps down, back in the race. Davey Allison's crew. Four laps now.
Scoreboard for us over here. Here comes Bill closing it back up again.
See right here, Neil, he's really strong up off the fourth corner, but that's about as far as he gets.
Bill had one good run at Davey. He can get one more here before the bonus bucks go away.
I think he's already made that big run at him, if you want to know the truth. You can get the tires hot, and they've kind of stabilized their distance there.
Yeah, it's kind of deal. You kind of put all your eggs in one basket and make one run at him. If it doesn't work, you kind of come up short. But I'm telling you, the Bills put some heat back on him. There's Larry McReynolds right in the middle, radioing Davey, telling him probably how far it is to halfway at lap times. I've had them call me before and say, just hold them off five more laps. And six laps later, just two more, hold them off.
Yeah.
They don't want to tell you how much work you got ahead of you.
Well, they can see that scoreboard as they roll off into turn number three. Lap 245. Next time is halfway.
Yeah, they're reaching for the white flag, getting it ready. There's Bill trying that outside line with one lap, one more lap opportunity to do it. See if his sails are off in here like it's the last lap. Here he comes.
Yep, he's going to make a run at him.
No.
Trying to turn it down under. Davey will protect that inside line just like it's the last lap. What does that thing say? King King to the bank?
Bring the cash register at the First National Bank in Hueytown.
You see Joey shake his head?
Yep.
More bonus, more bonus.
Davey Allison has won the Gillette Halfway Challenge and the $10,000 bonus. So if you entered the contest, they buy your phone. Davey Allison's the name to know if they call you, and you can jingle the keys to that new Chevrolet.
You think if he makes a deposit, I can borrow more? At the bank in Hueytown, maybe that's the way it looks. Before he puts in, before we borrow. Davey says, okay, I got the money. Go ahead, Bill.
lap late. Here comes Elliott.
Was that the same Davey said it really didn't matter if you leave the halfway mark while ago?
We're just past halfway, and Bill Elliott has taken the lead in what has been a Ford-dominated show. Elliott and Allison, Mark Martin, three Fords lead Harry Gantz, Oldsmobile, and Hut Strickland Chevrolet. There's the rest of your top 10, all GM cars. We'll be back after these messages and Harry Gantz's thoughts about 92.
I think the competition's going to be a little tougher this year than it was last year. Got some more Fords that are running. They're running stronger, better teams up front there. It's going to be real tough to win any race this year.
Back at Rockingham, watching the battle for eighth place on back. Ricky Rudd has just moved around Phil Parsons' lap car. Left of your screen is Brett Bodine. And we'll open up our 800 line if you have questions about the Goodwrench 500. We can answer here in the booth or pass along to Glenn Jarrett and Steve Evans to get answers for you on pit road. This is a toll-free call to TMM Motorsports. We'd like to get some of your questions on about the running of this Goodwrench 500. There's our 800 number, 1-800-451-7331.
It's Ken Slater coming down the pits.
Look at the mess on that windshield. Now, the other side's pretty clean where Rusty's got to look, but...
Yeah, Mike, they take an ammonia mixture, just dump on the left side right there in front of the driver. Here's Ken Schrader in for a stop. Looks like they're going to do all four tires. They're doing the rights. The left side guy's already got the lug nuts off. They'll bring that side up. They're putting rent. They're going with Bite in the car. They're taking Bite out of the car.
Taking it out.
Instead of putting it in, his car is too tight. They turn that jack screw to the left, which takes pressure off of the left rear wheel.
Now, we're only 55 laps past the last caution period. There's Bill Elliott, who was only 2 seconds away from lapping his Junior Johnson teammate Sterling Marlin. And the pole sitter, Kyle Petty, went a lap down while we were in commercial. So his chances at winning all that bonus money and over $200,000 today get more difficult.
In a place like Rockingham, it's certainly not beyond capable of doing it, but it makes it a lot tougher.
There is Kyle Petty, just overlapped by Bill Elliott. Let's check with Glenn Jarrett.
Well, these guys are seeing a possible $240,000 payday go by the wayside. Robin, what's wrong with the car now? What's Kyle saying?
I can't tell you exactly what he's saying, but it's not perfect. It's a little loose right now. We made some adjustments. We were good on the long run, and we tried to adjust to make it a little bit better on the short run, and... I guess it was the wrong way.
Well, is it something that you still feel that you can make an adjustment on and get the car competitive again?
We're going to try real hard.
Okay, they're going to do everything they can to try to keep that $240,000 in sight. And it's kind of interesting, he says, that he can't say everything that Kyle wants or that Kyle said about the car. They're not real happy down here right now.
No. Terry Labonte's on pit road now. He'll get right side tires.
Mike, if we can find somebody that can speak Spanish, we'll talk to Felix again, because he just changed gears probably.
Now, Schrader just went flying around Kyle. Not that Kyle's car is that bad, but Schrader has brand new tires. Just came out of pit road. Here's Hunt Strickland and Darrell Waltrip, and they're battling hard at fifth spot. Here comes Darrell. And it's only halfway.
Yeah, a little wiggly right there up off the corner. But somebody can handle that car is Darrell. He's got a lot of ability with that thing. He makes the pass.
And two, Darrell always runs his car with a lot of security in it. He does not like a loose race car, so it's really coming to him now.
Well, we saw two of the contenders on pit road. I thought it was a little early, but we see some more. We've only gone about 60 laps. Then that's the most we've run under green in one stretch today. Now here comes Labonte, and he's on fresh tires.
What a difference.
Yeah, boy, it makes you feel like a hero when they stick that new rubber on that thing. And not only is Labonte making a run, Schrader just went out, he passed Davey, and he's running down the leader to get a lap back. Did you see that rubber pile up on the side of that racetrack? It's almost like a cheese grater out there. It actually shears rubber off and it's just piled right on the edge of the racetrack.
Here's the 11th place car, Ernie Irvin, on pit road as we watch the battle for fifth.
Pat Strickler, extremely loose. Did you see that car, Neil, come up off the corner? It looked like it's going to swap ends there for a second.
Yep. Tony Glover and the Morgan McClure crew at work. They're going for four under green.
Well, I think after they see what it does to some of the cars that ran further back in the pack, what a big asset it was to have four tires on them. They're going to go, everybody's going to hear that. These guys look like they were putting a little bit in, buddy, where they were going
a little bit. That looked like a major adjustment for me. That's about six rounds of bait in that thing.
I tell you what's major is when they put the air wrench on that thing.
23.8 seconds for Ernie Irvin on pit road. He's pitted right next to Schrader, so they had a chance to look at not only what Schrader did, but look at the tires that came off the car, maybe talk to Richard Froome and compare Schrader's run with Ernie Irvin. Bobby Hamilton is in. He smoked the right front of his car. He's complete service on the Country Time old and goes back out. And here's Davey Allison, the second place car. You ride with him.
He's doing the most difficult thing there is in racing anymore. Leading or running second in the race and coming in the pits at 55 miles an hour from time we start down pit road. That is tough to do.
Steve?
Well, guys, the way this crew reacted is almost on a moment's notice. Davey must have said something on the radio. I don't like these tires anymore. I'm coming in. He didn't give a lot of time to prepare. They were already ready, of course. They always are. Taking rubber on all burgers and putting, jacking some wedge into the right-hand side of the automobile. Not taking it out, but putting it in, and they're gone in 20 seconds and change.
Steve, we saw something new there on the fueling. The one gas man went over, put the can in, and when it was almost empty, handed that can off to the catch can man, and then Norman Kojimuzu came over with the second can. That's a little different, and it looks like they might have saved a little time there.
20 seconds flat is plenty fast for you four tires.
Sterling Marlin in the pits, Harry Gant, the third place car coming in now to pit lane.
You make a pit stop, and if a caution would come out, it laps down. You hate to be the early guys in. See, here's the lug nuts already off the left front. There's not a lug nut left on that wheel. These guys are waiting. Ooh.
Glenn?
Well, the Mark Martin crew is getting ready for a four-tire change also. Steve Mill, the crew chief, told me they were going to watch the 28 car, and whatever he did, they were going to do. They had an idea that he was going to come into the pit. And Mark is pulling up just now. Harry Gant pulls out right in front of him. Close call there. Let's see if they can get Mark out as quick as Davey Allison sure got him out. So how they knew that Allison was going to make that stop, I don't know. These guys have waited, finding things out here. But they're pretty much playing their cards the way that Davey Allison's crew does.
Mark Martin continuing to get service.
See the man out there reaching out, cleaning that bottom of that grill area off this man's car.
You know, I just seen a black flag, Rusty Wallace. I think he might have left the pit road a little bit too fast or something. Maybe we'll bring him back in. He will not be a happy camper either.
Stop and go penalty. Mike Walter got service. Jeff Bodine is in. Brett Bodine in at the same time.
In days past, that stop and go wasn't so bad. You could come down pit road at 120 miles an hour, but nowadays it's a breaker. That thing, when you come in here 55 miles an hour, it's like a park.
That'll get another one if he don't slow down a little bit.
Right, you're doing 55 and everybody else is doing 150. There was a minor incident on pit road. Sterling Marlin and Morgan Shepherd banged together a bit as Marlin was leaving the pits and Shepherd was coming in.
There goes Rusty back out. They're still cleaning his side, leaving our side dirty on the windshield. We've got to do a little work on this.
Darrell Walter pit. 271 laps are completed. Bill Elliott is the leader. He has yet to make his pit stop, as does the second place car, Ricky Rudd. We'll return to Rockingham after this.
Welcome back to the Goodrich 500. I'm Steve Evans. I'm in the Bill Elliott pit. They are bringing him in under green for tires and fuel. I talked to Jim Brewer. I said, how long are you going to leave him out there? It depends on how quick Davey Allison's lap times are. Apparently, they got very quick on fresh rubber. So Bill Elliott is indeed coming in momentarily. Guys, you've got a better view than I do. You can see him out there.
Yeah, he's coming down pit road right now. Guys are ready to jump on the car.
And Junior, as usual, has the last pit on pit road. coming in and a quick jump going out. Steve?
Well, this is a typical junior driver. Perfection pit stop. You see Junior with the tire. Watch the precision that he's going to roll that left front tire up. He'll slide it right in. There'll be no wasted motion whatsoever. That is beautiful work. Choreography, it just can't beat NASCAR pit stop. 22 seconds.
I tell you, Steve, they don't have any wasted motion. They all get the job done to get that car out of there.
I like the ice dancing at the Winter Olympics, but I think this is better. Elliott back out. Davey Allison will be the leader. The short field back out. Davey will be the new leader. We'll update the field for you here in a second. Some of the callers to our 800 number. Ronnie from Johnson City wants to know if Elmo leaves the motor running in the pace car between cautions.
He actually does. He's out there with it running all the time. They also have a backup.
We have a little.
Chad Little and Ricky Rudd. And Ricky's locked up that left front, banged it in pretty good there. And he was right up near the leaderboard here. We're going to get a caution. Elmo, who keeps the motor running, is going to come out here with a pace car once again. Neil was saying they have a backup safety car, too, in case anything happens.
But he's been sitting there with the motor running. He wants to jump so it takes off the other.
Ricky Rudd got hard into the back of somebody. Shove sheet metal all up against that left front tire.
You know, you'd just be speculating, but I would think that with caution flags coming on, might somebody been coming in for the normal pit stop. Somebody turned that in front of me. No, it looks like they spun this one.
Chad Little got up in front of that car and crinkled the side. We will have a look at it. Let's see. And it's crisis corner, turn two.
Looks like they got together going down the back straightaway.
Yep.
Yeah, they got tangled up. Similar to the deal with Earnhardt and Kowicki on the straight, on the straightaway, and they both bounced it off the wall there.
Rudd had to work hard to keep the right side of that car off the wall. Looks like he might have done it, but the left side got carved up pretty well.
There's Davey Allison right behind it.
You know, it's bad to wreck a car, but on a straightaway, that's really bad. What's 52 doing?
Jimmy Means involved in that.
Maybe the 52 spun first and the other guys were backing out of the gas and got tangled up in it. I don't know.
We'll check further in a bit. First gear, Davey Allison stop under caution. Just completed.
Now, these caution flags are expensive for car owners. They just put on four brand new tires, they run five laps, and they get to spend another grand and put them four more on.
Here's Flag.
Well, there is some serious damage on the front of this car here. The left front fender was tagged all in on the tire. They had to actually pick the car up. The guys had to pick the car up physically before they could even get a jack in it. The left front tire was flat, so it has done some damage. Right now, they're just fixing it cosmetically. I've got an idea that they may want to bring that car back in on the next caution lap to make sure that there wasn't any damage that they did not see. Probably got a tow-in problem that made it bother him, but he's back out of the way right now.
Rusty Wallace got a good piece of something out there, too.
You know, here's Rusty's car damage. We didn't even see that. We've seen three different cars damaged in different places in the racetrack.
We've been at Rockingham all day. Now I think we're at Wreckingham.
Yeah, happens in a hurry. Here we go. We should be able to see this one.
I guess. Brace yourself, folks.
Boom. Oh, me.
Jimmy Means.
Now we know why Jimmy Means went down to the inside.
Aren't you glad that camera wasn't on the bumper? I know Peter Larson is. Rusty's back out.
I don't know what happened there. I don't know if that accident was in front of them.
Now, instead of slowing that down, let's see that as Rusty did in real time.
Okay, Jimmy sees the wreck. He slows down and boom.
Rusty lifted for a total of a half of a second there. It was the deal like you're talking about, buddy. They saw the wreck in front of him. And, you know, Rusty was coming out of the corner. He couldn't see it.
281 laps complete as they clean up here at Rockingham. We're going to get one to go. Mark from Kingsport wants to know how manufacturers' points are determined. We've talked a lot about that championship today. The winning make of car in each Winston Cup race gets 9 points. Second place, not the second place car, but the next make back. So give you more on that in a moment. Tonight, Inside Winston Cup Racing is live, 9 p.m. live from Charlotte. Felix Sabates and Kyle Petty will be Ned Jarrett's guests at 9 o'clock Eastern Time. We'll be right back. Back under green at Rockingham, Bill Elliott is leading Davey Allison with a running right now. Two Fords in front. We started talking about manufacturer's points. If the Fords finish 1-2, Ford gets 9 points. The next make of car to finish, doesn't matter what spot, but the next make back gets 6 points. The next make gets 4. And the other make in the race gets 3. It's the old Grand Prix point system, 9-6-4-3-2-1. But it's not the first 6 cars in the race. It's the order in which the best placed car of each manufacturer finishes. So at Daytona, Ford won. They got 9 points. Oldsmobile was 5th. They were the first non-Ford. They got 6 points. Pontiac got 4 and Chevy got 3. If it worked the other way, Ford might get them all today. Yeah. They would have at Daytona.
There's Bill with just a little bit higher line than Davey. They both got him a good place to work and they're sticking with it.
The Cale Yarborough car, Chad Little at the wheel, the number 66 car. To answer David's question from Pomona Beach, Cale is here. He's up on top of the truck spotting for Chad. There's problems, he'll come down to the pit, but usually he acts as the team spotter and check writer.
He's real active with the race team. He's enthusiastic about getting it competitive.
Brett Bodine and Ernie Irvin working along there.
Brett Bodine's car looked like it's had some damage. It's been hit on the left side a little bit. It looked like the right rear quarter sticking out on it. Hadn't been anything really, really major, but he's got it beat, banged up pretty good.
Those doors, like at every restaurant I go in North Carolina, they got them hanging on the walls and everything else. So that's a candidate right there for a restaurant.
Everybody's collecting all these parts and pieces that come off these race cars now.
This race is for 7th place.
You know, Ernie drove his heart out today. He just hadn't ever got up there where he had a chance to run for the lead.
If you can sit back here in a position like this, you'll be turning virtually the same lap times as the leaders, but you're just out of position. You're sitting there turning lap after lap. As good as the leader, you're just not in the right place.
Now, everybody back there says Ernie does stupid things. You see him back out of that car not to get himself where it made it 3 deep through there.
No, I agree. Glenn Jarrett?
Well, after all that action on the racetrack, it made things fast and furious down here in the pits. I talked to Eddie Dickerson, who is the crew chief for Rusty Wallace. He says that Rusty ran into the back of Jimmy Means. They thought they might have a problem, but Rusty says the car feels pretty good right now. Car number 5, Ricky Rudd, also involved, has got more serious problems. They weren't able to tell what was going to go on with the car until he got back out and got up to speed. He's running slow on the inside of the racetrack, so they're going to have to bring him back in shortly. Kyle Petty came in right before that. They did put 3 rounds of bite in the car. Robin Pemberton says that they think that the excessive heat today is warmer than they thought it was going to be, has just made the car loose. But the guy that did the most was car number 68, Bobby Hamilton. They came in, added a rubber to the right front spring, took out 2 rounds of bite. They added 3 in the left side, and they moved the track bar down and changed 4 tires on that pit stop without losing a lap.
And while you're talking about that, Glenn, here comes Ricky Rudd back into the pits to see if they can repair some of that damage.
And he'll go behind the wall. What a tough day for Ricky Rudd in the Tide Ride. Still with this race for 7th here, Brett Bodine and Ernie Irvin.
These guys have been together all day long. It kind of works out. A couple of guys that have cars pretty equal, and they got to race each other all day. The only problem, they're not racing with the guys for the lead. Mike Waltrip, his car's ran good off and on all day.
And we're back up front with the 2 Fords.
Also, all these major adjustments they're making on these cars, if you notice, when they go through 1 and 2 down there, it's beginning to shadow up. So that's going to change the temperature. And a lot of these changes they're making, we're going to wish they didn't right near the end.
Seems like we spent the entire day looking out one end of this race car or the other. the first part, we were looking out the rear, now we're looking out the front a little bit. Usually, when you see a car buddy like Bill slide up, when you're behind you, say, boy, I got it now. He'll slide up, and then Davey Steele's not able to make that move in the middle of the corner. And Bill can run high off the corner and actually make up ground at times.
Here we're back at 11th place. Hut Strickland and Rusty Wallace. Those cars are now being shown one lap down. Here are the first of the cars one lap down. That include Kyle Petty, Rick Mass, and Richard Petty, along with Morgan Shepherd, Jeff Bodine, and Sterling Marlin.
Both these cars you're looking at got stop-and-go penalties a while ago on their pit stops. They come in a little too quick. That's why they're lapped down.
What, Jarrett?
Ricky Rudd's car right now, they've got a welder out here. Ricky hit something so hard that it has broken the track bar, the front track bar, loose the mounts on the roll bars of the chest. You can see the welding going on. I've never seen this happen before. He hit something really hard to do that. It has broken it loose on the left side as well as the right side. It's torn completely away. There's a crewman in the way there right now. But this is a major repair. Even if he does get back out there, he's going to have to take it awfully easy, because the amount of stress and tension that is on this suspension right now will not allow him to drive this car as fast as what he was. So this is an unusual repair being made right here.
It looked like there's also putting a right front shock mount on the car. He must have really hit something. That looks like the shock mount that they were fixing to repair and put back on the car.
Back up front, Elliott and Allison. Have a look through the field here. Race summary. Bill Elliott led 67 laps. Davey Allison led most of the rest. 10 cars are on the lead lap. 5 drivers have swapped the lead back and forth 10 times. 7 caution flags for 28 laps. It slowed the average speed to 120 miles an hour. Here are some of the drivers that have led the race today. Pontiacs and Fords. Cars out of the race. Johnny McFadden ran 8 laps. Dave Marcus, 22 laps. Andy Belmont, Dale Jarrett, Dick Trickle, water pump trouble, and Greg Sachs is out of the race. I believe Del McCoward is also in the garage along with Stan Smith. What kind of season will this be for Bill Elliott? He'll tell you, and then we'll take this break for messages.
From what I'm concerned, it's just, you know, at least I've got a job. I've got a, you know, a good ride. A, you know, got good people around me with all the juniors guys. And, you know, Tim and I have worked very well so far together. And, you know, I'm sure there's going to be rough parts of this road, but, you know, who said it was ever going to be easy? But, you know, I feel like we've got a lot to add to each other.
TNN Motorsports live coverage of the Goodwrench 500 is being brought to you by Budweiser, the king of beers with that clean, crisp, cold taste. Nothing beats a Bud. And they're out front. That Junior Johnson Budweiser Ford, Bill Elliott. Davey Allison in hot pursuit. They're about to lap the Keystone Ford, Wally Dahlenbeck in the second Jack Roush car. Rookie contender. There's how they're running at 308 laps. 3 Fords, an Oldsmobile, and a Chevrolet in the top 5. Then a Pontiac, a Chevy, a Ford. Here are the Bonnie Dolls and Darrell Walter. Check that. Labonte's in a Chevrolet this year. That's right.
You know, if you wonder about the course of events, there we were with Gant, your first GM product in there. That's a pretty good indication of the strides Ford made at the end of the season and the offseason coming back, because Gant would be sitting here leading the race, which he did last year. You know, good chance, but Ford really turned up the wick on their race car stuff and got some good parts and pieces, and they're going to be tough.
And with a lot more teams, it's a lot easier to get development feedback. That's one advantage Chevrolet had for so many years, with everybody running the small block Chevy engine and not that many teams running the Ford. Glenn?
This is Larry McReynolds, crew chief on Davey Allison's car. Larry, for a long time there, Davey led run away until you got to that $10,000 bonus. Now, all of a sudden, he seems content to run in second place. Is there a problem, or are you just kind of sorting things out?
Well, the track has got a little bit greasy, and we're just a little bit loose right now. Right now, he's saying, like, we beat Bill in 1 and 2, and Bill beats us in 3 and 4. And we ain't catching the traffic exactly right either, but, I said all winter long that 11 car was going to be tough, and he's proving it here today. We're just going to keep making adjustments, hopefully building up at the end.
Well, what's the next thing you're going to have to do to the car?
We'll probably put a little bit of spoiler on it maybe next time. Either spoiler or a little bit of wedge.
Well, we kind of speculated that Davey might be just making laps, but he does have a little bit of looseness.
Nevertheless, he's catching Bill Elliott. Got that down to a car length now. First to second, 313 laps down.
You know, we heard him say that Davey says he's beating him right here in 1 and 2. Davey thinks his car is better at this part of the racetrack, and he says Bill is beating him up at the other end.
That's the shadow part of the racetrack, and up where the sun's right on the banking, he's losing a little bit of ground.
So that difference will become more pronounced as the day goes on, and that turn two gets more covered in shade.
Yeah, that's a strange racetrack. When that sun starts down, I'll tell you, 1 and 2 gets almost dark.
Darrell Waltrip in 10th place, last car on the lead lap. He's about 3.6 seconds from being lapped by this pair. Cars on the lead lap, Elliott, Allison, Mark Martin, third, Harry Gannon, fourth, Kenny Schrader, fifth, Mike Waltrip, sixth, Bernie Irvin, seventh, Brett Bodine, eighth, Terry Labonte, ninth, and Darrell Waltrip.
You know, when two guys are racing this hard, they really start lapping guys more than they normally would. You know, if Elliott was sitting there with Davey a half a straightaway back, he might not be running that car quite that hard. When they get to racing like this, they're going to put a lot of guys a lap down.
Call from Gary in St. Louis. Wanted to know if any woman had ever driven a Winston Cup race here above the 500 miles. As you look out from Davey Allison's car at the back bumper, Bill Elliott. Rick Fielden's our statistician and looked in his four volumes of 40 years of stock car racing and showed us that Janet Guthrie ran here in 1977 in the October race. Finished ninth. Had a good run here in that Ralph Moody car. Here's Harry Gant working around a bunch of traffic and Kenny Schrader trying to go with him. There's a good example of where you catch the traffic, and Gant just caught himself a bit of advantage there.
Well, one thing about Gant, no matter where he's running, if he's running dead left, he's trying as hard as he possibly can, and he don't wait on people in traffic. He goes to the high side or low side or the flat part of the racetrack to get by him.
Schrader right here. He ran good at the first of the race.
He is the first of the cars one lap down. Just ahead of Rusty Wallace and Kyle Petty. Strickland in the number 12 car, the Ray Bestas car. This right at 11th place.
Yeah, Mike, there's Schrader, you know, running fifth, and there's him going right on around him. He just got out of sync on that stop all ago.
318 of 492. The lap is complete. Davey Allison talks about 1992 as we take this break.
Did have a good year last year, and of course over the winter we questioned like everybody else did whether we could keep that momentum rolling. And to start the year off with a win at Daytona, I think answered the question for ourselves. So we're real excited about this year. We're anxious to get things underway. We got one out of 29 down, we've got 28 more to go.
We're back live at Rockingham on TNN. Mike Joy with Neil Bonnet and Buddy Baker, topside. Down on pit road today, Steve Evans and Glenn Jarrett. Up front, Bill Elliott. Running second, Davey Allison. Here's Steve.
I talked to Tim Brewer during commercial, the crew chief on the Bill Elliott number 11 car currently in the lead. And I said, Tim, this is starting to look like a mass race. And he laughed. He said, we have one strategy right now, and it's three words. Stay in front. We're only running that car hard enough to stay ahead of Allison.
Boy, Steve, just as you were saying that, Bill Elliott ran up behind a real slow car, and Davey just about got under him and almost into the back of him.
That was Mike Skinner's car out of Greensboro. Still run 1-2. Mark Martin's back in third. Harry Gant in fourth. Mike Waltrip fifth. Question out of Bob from Colorado. You go in the showroom, the T-Bird's rear-wheel drive, and the Chevy Lumina is a front-wheel drive. Not the case here.
No, they opened the door for that a long time ago when they started allowing you to put rear-wheel drive on any of the cars. There, any car would switch it over to rear-wheel drive for Winston Cup racing.
So they're all rear drive on the racetrack. 14th place at stake here, Rick Mann from the Richard Jackson. Skoal Olds. He has the spot. Richard Petty wants it. They're among those cars that are running one lap down. Morgan Shepherd's right in there with them.
Darrell Waltrip just went a lap down. As good as he's been running, Bill Elliott just put him a lap down.
Let's check with Glenn.
These are the hands of Andy Petrie, crew chief on Harry Gant's car. They're going about things a little differently right now. What Andy is doing is calculating fuel mileage. They're going back to their last stop, figuring how far they can go under green before they make the next stop. They're figuring on this thing possibly going green the rest of the way. They want to make sure they don't cut themselves short on the next pit stop so that they have to make two stops. They only want to make one more stop. That's what Harry Gant's crew chief is doing right now. They're figuring to the very last possible lap how far he can go before they have to bring him back in.
Harry Gant, who tore him up last fall, September and October, reeled off a string of Busch Grand National and Winston Cup wins right in a row. Two different teams, two different cars, different days, didn't matter. And he's running well here today, as he did last fall. Not as well as these two Fords.
Now, Bill's putting a little bit of distance on Davey right now. But that very well could have happened with a lap car. You know, as we were talking about, every time you get around one, you lose three or four positions.
Jimmy Spencer up there in the Harry Gant crew.
And there was Bill. There was Bill in a boxed-in group. He got boxed in there just a minute, and there's Davey right on his back bumper again.
Napa brings you this rundown. The way they're running just a bit ago. You know, we mentioned the Davey Allison that changed engines this morning. Larry from Georgia wanted to know why he was still allowed to start 10th. If you change cars during the week after qualifying, you have to go to the back. But the same car can change engines. In fact, some teams routinely do after qualifying and still start where you run and qualify.
Well, if you change cars, you have to go to the rear, of course. Right. But a motor, I mean, they change these things like you change socks. They're, you know, every day they change motors and all, like you change the carburetors and stuff. So that's not a penalty they make you go to the rear for.
Buddy, most of those teams in there, as you know, have seven or eight engines in that truck. And during the way after qualifying, they might put five of them in there and see which one they like for the race, and they'll just stick another one in at any time.
Well, most of them even have a qualifying motor that they do only qualifying with.
Let's check with Steve Evans.
You know, I'd just like to make a quick comment on this crowd, if I might. If you see an empty seat here today at Rockingham, it's because he or she is at the hot dog stand. Track president Frank Wilson smiling from ear to ear. This place is a total sellout. Concert attendance is down. In fact, we're canceling concert tours for lack of interest. Motion picture attendance over the holidays was very disappointing. And this is not just NASCAR. It's automobile racing as a whole. We saw this in the opening drag race out in California, the Winter Nationals, jam-packed Phoenix International Raceway with the Silver Crown cars. Again, a massive crowd. So all in all, motorsports in the good old USA is mighty healthy. Looking at this crowd.
And it's not just Winston Cup. They had a full house here for the Busch race yesterday.
Biggest crowd they've ever had for a Busch race on Saturday.
And probably one of the best races I've ever watched.
Excellent. Excellent show. Ward Burton got his first win. Mark Martin, Davey Allison, Dale Earnhardt, and Kenny Wallace, the top five.
I think you just said the key, an excellent show. You can pack them in here and you put out a lousy show, they don't come back. But the Busch Racing and the Winston Cup have been cranking out some good races for the past few years, and people are willing to come back and see them.
Right now they're watching Bill Elliott put on a driving display, but Davey Allison hasn't been much more than this distance away from him.
I tell you, Davey's a tough little fella. You see him just sitting there biding his time. He's not going crazy. He's not crossing the car up or doing anything to get the tires hot. He's running his race. And I wouldn't be surprised when they get down to the end, we're going to see one tremendous race.
Lapping Wally Dallenbach.
Someone called him Wally Dallenbach on what type of car. That was a Ford Thunderbird that Wally's driving.
Jack Roush car. Teammate to Mark Martin.
One thing about Wally, you know, he's back way back in the back right now, but he's gaining something that a lot of these guys are not gaining. He's gaining a tremendous amount of maturity as far as a driver. He's never run here before. He's smart. He's not getting in the way. He's not getting himself in trouble. He's learning a lot about what he's doing.
Quite true. Let's pick up this battle here. 13th position, Kyle Petty, trying to win all that bonus money, and it's going to be a tall order as he is a lap down and distance to the race leader. He's in 13th place. Oops. He's in 14th place. As Rick Mast goes by, here comes Dad. Richard and Kyle racing for position. And 14th changes hands.
It's easy to see why he's falling back. The car just about got away from him on that one pass.
And
he's
again
breaking the rear loose right here.
Keep
breaking
the
it loose again.
Going down.
When you got a car capable of sitting on the pole, you're dealing with a lot of horsepower. And that's good as long as you got it hooked up. But now the car's off a little bit and he's spinning the wheels a lot.
Makes for a long day's work.
When they're doing that, you're trying to decide whether a tire's going flat or if you got, he's got a tremendous motor in that car. We know that by what he qualified. So every time he stomps down on it and it's handling bad, it'll cross up on him.
Back up front, they're lapping
the second junior Johnson car, the Maxwell House car for Sterling Marlin. I believe that'll put Sterling two laps down.
Mike, I think we're seeing something right here. Look at Davey Allison where he's at. He's tried it in the bottom lap after lap after lap. He was able to maintain the speed of Bill. The last two laps, with not even a car around him, he's ran high, done in one and two, and then he's actually been running a little bit higher. The time before, he was two lengths higher than it. He's looking for a place on that racetrack that he can pass and try to pick up a little bit more speed.
There's the separation, first to second. Bill Elliott over Davey Allison. Mark Martin in third, Harry Gant fourth. Michael Waltrip having a good run today, as he did at Daytona. Coming up toward the front, he started sixth and finished seventh here last year. Mike Walters currently running fifth. Here's your top five after 338 laps. We'll be right back. TNN Motorsports live coverage of the Goodwrench 500 is brought to you by NAPA, because there are no unimportant parts. Bill Elliott moves up to put a second lap on Richard Petty, the King, in his next to last Rockingham appearance. Ran real well the first half of the race on the lead lap. And was about to go two down.
It's not that he's running bad. Bill Elliott and Allison are just running so well. They're just hooked up and they're going on about their business.
Well, it looks like Bill's getting some distance on Davey. He's going to have to go back to... Davey was trying some different areas. He'll have to go back to his bread and butter and see if he can close that gap back up.
Elliott is starting to stretch it out. Call from Pennsylvania. We've got the in-car cameras today with Davey Allison, Mark Martin, and Rusty Wallace. Dave from Pennsylvania wants to know who makes that decision, who gets the in-car cameras. Dave, most of those decisions are first extended to the sponsors of the cars in the race to see if they wish to cover the cost of carrying the in-car camera. That's how it's done on most of the networks. Ernie Irvin following Kenny Schrader there. That's for position. That's seventh place. Those two Chevrolets have battled back and forth all day. Both have had a good run, but again, those two Fords, Elliott and Allison, have been pretty superior to the field since about the 10th lap of this race.
And there goes Ernie right on by Kenny, making a move on the inside.
Here comes Bobby Hamilton. Schrader's just been off just enough that he hadn't really made a good run today. I know he's trying his heart out, but this car is just not handling right.
And I should elaborate. I think I said the race sponsor. The sponsors of the telecast, it's strictly a TV network decision who carries those in-car cameras rather than NASCAR or the racetrack. Ernie Irvin, good run today. Seventh place right now, trying to move up on Brett Bodine. Sixth in the Kenny Bernstein car. Now, there's a team that had such high hopes coming into this season. And here's another one, Alan Kulwicki. For Alan, let's get a count here off the NASCAR scoring monitor. He is 134 laps down.
So much for aerodynamics. He's passing everything on the racetrack. He's only got a quarter of the car left.
Yep. Got caught up in the back straightaway with Dale Earnhardt. And spent a long time in the garage area with Paul Andrews and his crew making repairs. Ernie Irvin will pit, and Schrader will come right with him. Rusty Wallace is on pit road.
Here we go with Harry Gant and Mark Martin. They're racing for position. Mark was up under Gant the lap before. Couldn't quite get by. Here comes Gant in the pits, and they're coming in together.
You'll see a good bit of this tag teaming now. Everybody's found a dancing or drafting partner to run through this next tank of fuel.
I'm going to tell you, that's exactly what it looks like to the race car driver. That's a great camera right there. I love that shot.
That's off the roof of Mark Martin's car. Steve?
So Mark Martin's car is in. You can see the jack already working on the right-hand side of the jet pin, especially the lightweight jack around it, or will he? Yep, here he comes right now. They'll take tires on all four corners. We don't see the Jack Roush crew making any kind of chassis adjustments. 22 gallons of fuel or whatever it will hold going in that automobile. And I have to wonder, guys upstairs, if this match race with Elliott and Allison, they won't follow each other in the pits whenever that happens.
Well, I tell you what, Steve, it's just a call by the crew chief. I'm sure they're listening to each other's radios. They can monitor each other to if they want to or not. They can pick up the other guy, and they might make that call.
Steve, I think you may have been blocked there, as I thought I saw somebody taking one round of wedge out of the right rear of Mark Martin's car.
Well, they do that stuff so quick, it's hard to catch all of it.
Brett Bodine finishing up a stop.
That answers the question. Here comes Davey Allison in by himself. Elliott stayed on the racetrack, and Davey's now coming down pit road.
That shows you they don't want to work with Elliott. They just want to beat him.
Now, we'll take a look at this thing, see if we can tell if they changed that car. They said the car was a little bit loose. We'll see if they work on Davey's car.
Glenn?
Well, Allison has brought the 28 Thunderbird in for pit service. He's getting right side tires. We're watching to see if they make that chassis adjustment that Larry McReynolds talked about a while ago. Thus far, it's been confined to a four tire change. They have not done anything to the spoiler, nothing to the jack screw. So they just put four tires down.
Talk about they might do some spoiler work. They didn't touch the spoiler area either, so they must think he's pretty close.
22 gallons in these cars. Same size fuel cell used on the short as on the long tracks. Charlie from Rhode Island wanted to know. Very uniform.
How would you like to play poker with this guy? His face hadn't changed since the green flag started.
I played with him for 3 years. You can never tell, I'm telling
you. Mike Walter. He's the second-place car right now. Elliott is the leader.
Here comes Elliott also coming in behind Mike.
One lap later. They look like they're crawling down pit road, but there is a speed limit. And the way the drivers tell what the limit is, we've had several questions on this. During the pace laps, the pace car brings them down pit road at the speed limit. And the drivers look on their tachometer in what, Neil, second gear, would you say?
They use second gear coming down through there.
Here's Steve.
Elliott is in. Absolutely no chassis adjustment. He must be happy with that car. Tires on all four corners to be expected. There's Junior Johnson in with his patented roll. Another perfect positioning of the tire. But apparently Elliott's very happy with that car. Who wouldn't be?
That's right, Steve. That thing has worked flawlessly all day. Here's Glenn.
After Davey Allison's pit stop, I talked to Larry McReynolds as to why they didn't make that adjustment. He said, well, the more Davey ran the car, he said it felt real good in three and four. The car gets loose coming off of two. They were afraid that if they messed with it too much, that they might get it off on both ends of the racetrack. Larry simply said, you win the race coming off of turn four. It feels good there now.
A lot of service going on. Morgan Shepherd in the pits as we watch from Davey Allison's car following Terry Labonte. Now moving to the outside of the Sunoco Chevrolet. There's Bill Elliott. And he is once again the leader. Allison is second, Gant third, Mark Martin fourth. Brett Bodine moved up to fifth, and Mike Walter sixth.
You know, the distance between the two is just like before they made the stop. Both teams were right together.
Yeah, but buddy, I tell you what, we saw in the other stop, in that first caution, the caution prior to this, Bill went a lot longer than anyone else. He stayed out there longer, but when he went out, he was a straightaway behind. I think they saw the fact that the new tires, the longer they ran those old tires, he got so far behind, they had to come in as soon as Davey did this time.
Because if that's five laps that Davey gets to run on fresh tires and you don't have them, you're just going to fall that much more behind.
Yeah, they stretched it before and they lost a straightaway to Davey. This time they came in right after Davey.
360 laps complete here at The Rock. Bill Elliott leads Davey Allison. Harry Gant now third and Mark Martin fourth. What's Dale Earnhardt looking for in 1992? Let's ask him and then pause for this break.
And it is. I think it's going to be one of the toughest years for anybody to be able to, you know, dominate. I think it's going to be a year where this guy wins, this guy wins. You might have a guy have a little bit of a good, you know, fast streak, but win streak. It's going to be so competitive.
365 laps complete here in Rockingham. Bill Elliott leading Davey Allison, Harry Gant, Mark Martin, and Brett Bodine in the top five. And there's news from the pits of Davey Allison. Glenn Jarrett.
Well, we're all familiar with baseball players, football players, and basketball players who have to play hurt. This is Joey Knuckles, who's the tire changer on Davey Allison's Thunderbird. Joey has a problem with his knee right now. Joey, what's going on?
Well, I'm playing Neil Bonnet today. We're out here, we're riding hurt. Yesterday we were in a panic changing motors and I twisted my ankle real bad and they worked on me pretty extensively last night and I had to take off and go racing. If I can make it two or three more pit stops, these boys go to victory lane,
I'm gonna go to the hospital.
Okay, but I imagine that pain will be lessened a great deal if he does get to go to victory lane.
Well, a few minutes ago, you saw on that pit stop, that was Joey doing acrobatics over the front of the car, finished up with that right front, did a spin pirouette. Was that a triple axel or a salchow? I don't know. I didn't follow figure skating in the Olympics, but that's what he looked like going over there to change that left front. Davies in second place, trying to win back-to-back. Stay atop the Winston Cup point.
Mike, when we look at this gap we're dealing with right here, here's Elliott coming into frame, and there's Davey way back there. They were hoping that if they didn't change the car, they'd still be in good shape. This, what we're seeing right now, might make them have to make a change. They might have to, Davey's guys might have to say, well, we got to do something to be able to catch Elliott. So they might not have that option to just go in like they are if they're going to win the race.
Elliott running down Darrell Waltrip, who is the lap down. Only four cars now, one lap down. Terry Labonte, Rusty Wallace, Hutch Strickland, and Darrell. Dallas moving past the Phil Parsons car, which spent a lot of time in the garage. Came back out 147 laps down.
You know, if we've talked all day about Davey's car gets better, but if it was anybody other than this 11 car here, but that car is showing that same ability. The longer he runs, the better he gets. Here they are trying to put Walter in the lap down.
And Hutch Strickland, who's also shown in that group, one lap down. Now Strickland and Waltrip are racing for position. They are 11th and 12th. Back just behind them at 13th is Rick Mast, and 14th is Richard Petty. They are two laps down.
Okay, while they're racing like that, Davey's closing in on Bill a little bit.
Just ahead of them, Darrell and Hutt are going at it. There's Harry Gant moving around Stanley Smith's car and Chad Little. Gant back up in the high group. Steve?
Well, you know, Mike, look at this bucket full of nuts, huh? These are the lug nuts off of the Bill Elliott car, and the race isn't even over yet. Now, they never reuse them because the air wrenches are very hard on the thread. What happens to them? Well, they probably throw them away. But considering how aggressive souvenir sellers are in Winston Cup racing, can't believe somebody hasn't figured out how to engrave on one flat side the car number on the other flat side, the race track, and maybe a driver's autograph with one of those electric pencils and sell it for a couple of bucks. Could be a business opportunity.
Well, there's some guy that's selling little section pieces of old race tires. I don't know why you couldn't sell lug nuts, Steve. Maybe there's a second calling for you there.
I doubt, seriously, those will hit the garbage can. Somebody will get them.
You bet. You bet.
Here's Elliott getting around Darrell. But if you look, there's Davey right there on him. That little bit of time that it took him to get around him, Davey's really closed in on him.
Now, just ahead of the race leaders, that battle for 11th and 12th, Hutch Strickland. There's Darrell Walter right in the middle of it. We talk a lot about this manufacturer battle. We've got several questions. One of why Buick is gone, and that was a General Motors decision. They would concentrate on Chevrolet and Pontiac in NASCAR based on Harry Gant's success and keep a few Oldsmobile teams this year to run out existing contracts, but the Buick deals were up, and GM pulled the plug on that. But as far as why there are more Ford teams, well, that's where a lot of the Buick teams went.
Yeah, whenever they pull the Buick money out, pull the support out, they look to, well, what area do we go in? They see Ford doing some aggressive things, so they jumped the fence and went over there and got some stuff from Ford Motor Company. They're real aggressive right now in the sport.
Kenny Bernstein's team went from Buick to Ford, and so did the Stavola team, the Snickers team. Well, if you're driving around Goldsboro, North Carolina, wave to Carol Gibbs. She'll be driving her new Chevy Lumina. She knew that Davey Allison led the halfway lap. Gillette called her. She got the keys to the brand new Chevy Lumina Z34. There's another contest for Richmond, and you can call any time for that 900 number. And list yourself to be called back during the running of the Pontiac Excitement 400 next Sunday at Richmond. Here's Brett Bodine in the Kenny Bernstein car, a Ford. They had such high hopes at Daytona, and a distributor chewed up the drive gear on the camshaft, and he was out of the race early, but here he's having a fine day. Glenn?
This is Donnie Richardson, the crew chief for Brett Bodine. I wanted to say Jeff, but this is Brett. Donnie, your car's a little beaten battered. Got some tire marks down the side. The back end's been knocked in, but Brett's getting around pretty good.
Yeah, Brett's doing an extremely good
good job just trying to keep a steady pace. We got in a little altercation earlier, but we've come back from it. I just sorry that my car owner, Kenny Bernstein, can't be here with us to kind of see this. And some people from Quaker State, there's Scott and Homer at home watching, I'm sure. But we're going to be in the top five, I think, if we just get a little luck.
Well, you've got one more pit stop to make. Do you have to make any adjustments? How does Brent play the car field now?
No, we haven't made any adjustments for the last few stops. The car's working pretty good. It's just taking a long time to come on. The longer it runs, the better it seems to get.
Brett Bodine looking for a fine run here today. He is fifth. Right behind him, Mike Waltrip is sixth. Ford and Pontiac. Where's that question, buddy? Steve, don't ask. Please don't ask. But we actually got a question in. Guy wants to know, what size pants does Junior Johnson wear? Neil, you drove for him. What bearing that has on this race, I'm not sure. So
he wears the boss's pants. It doesn't matter what size they are. He's the boss all the time.
He puts them on one leg at a time. Bill Elliott, he's about taking the pants off this field, but for Davey Allison. Elliott nearly scored his very first Winston Cup win here at Rockingham. It was 1983. Richard Petty beat him by half a car length. Richard's 196th career win was not Bill Elliott's first. Bill has won 34 times since that close call. Here are the drivers that have led the race today. Two Pontiacs and three Fords. Kyle Petty from the pole. But Elliott's now led for 149 laps. Only eight cars left on the lead lap, and five drivers have swapped the lead back and forth 11 times. Three since lap 282. Here are some of the drivers that are out of today's race. We'll be back with more of the Goodwrench 500 after this. 385 laps down, 107 laps from the conclusion of the Goodwrench 500. The battle we're watching is for fifth place, Brett Bodine and Mike Waltrip. Bill Elliott continues to lead Davey Allison. Harry Gant and Mark Martin. Ernie Irvin and Kenny Schrader are also posted on the lead lap. Eight cars on the lead lap. One lap back, Terry Labonte, Rusty Wallace. Two laps down, Darrell Waltrip, Hunt Strickland, Rick Mass, Richard Petty, and Sterling Marlin, along with Morgan Shepherd, Jeff Bodine, Kyle Petty, and then Bobby Hamilton. These two have kept close tabs on one another for these last 50, 60 laps. Even, did they pit together? I forget if they did.
Yeah, but Mike Waltrip, he'll pull up there right on the back bumper and almost make a pass, and then he'll drop back, and it seems like he's doing it in spurts, and I guess that contributes to the getting the tires hot back and forth.
Buddy, you owned one of these race teams for a while, and you and Danny Schiff, the car that you drove. Rick from California wants to know, how many parts on that car, running, say, a Pontiac, are made by Pontiac?
Very little, believe me. Body parts, windshield, and the rest of it, you know, the chassis and all, pretty much the same for Ford, Chevrolet, Pontiac, all of them. Actually, the parts that they make the engine parts, of course, you know, the block and stuff like that. But as far as wheel bearings and stuff like that, they all have specialized bearings that they use, and spindles are made special for these cars. Axles are special. The whole car is just, it's a race car.
Stock appearing rather than stock car might be the term, but stock car is how they've been known. Gosh, back in the middle 50s, we've seen old films where they would tear down a car and inspect it, and if it wasn't exactly like the car in the showroom, it would go home. Times change, technology grows along, and the sport gets more competitive, not less, as a result.
When they started building these racetracks like this, if you put a production car on there right now, no matter how well they're built, they just couldn't go the distance. You had to build all these heavy-duty parts. It's mostly, probably, the car's probably 85% aftermarket heavy-duty parts.
Bill Elliott is coming up to lap the seventh-place car, Ernie Irvin. 100 laps to go. What was anticipated to be a Ford Chevrolet showdown, and it's been a Ford show. Saw Michael Krenefuss in the Davey Allison pit a while ago. He's Ford's worldwide racing boss. Probably has his hand on his wallet right now. One of those teams is likely to get that $50,000 bonus the way we're running right now. Here's one of the fellows who could be the spoiler, Mike Waltrip. He's one of the highest placed GM cars right now. Harry Gantz-Olds is third. Waltrip's Pontiac is sixth. Glenn?
Well, guys, I came down to the Michael Waltrip pit, talked to crew chief Bill Ingalls. He said that they're not really happy right now with the set of tires that's on the car. They're not sticking to the track as well as previous sets. The car wants to skate a little bit. And if Michael doesn't drive a perfect line around the racetrack each time, he loses a little bit of time. So they're wanting to, they're waiting for the next caution period or the next scheduled pit stop to come in and maybe put on a little better set of tires. Now, in addition, I talked to Junior Johnson in response to that question that they called in. And I asked Junior what size pants he wore, and he just looked at me and laughed and said, he didn't have to tell me.
Told you not to ask him.
I'll tell you what, Mike, I'll do this much for Junior. They're smaller than they were about 6 months ago.
Yeah.
He's been losing weight and working at it.
Yeah. Mike Walter, the Pennzoil Pontiac. Chuck Ryder and Lawrence Terry.
And what a great run he had in Daytona to have it happen so close to the end. Everybody thought there was going to be a shootout between he and the other two Fords, and to have an engine go that close to the end, you know?
He said he had enough for Davey Allison. We'll never know.
That's kind of like the fish that got away, though. We'll never know that.
But it feels nice to get him on the line before he breaks the line.
Yeah. Had a third at Darlington last year, had a second at Pocono the year before his best career finish. Well, we've already had one rookie winner this weekend, Ward Burton, yesterday. Drove the Gwaltney's car to victory in the Busch Grand National race. That was a Buick. Buick's still involved in Busch Series racing with their V6 program.
I think that's one of the keys to the Buick involvement. They've decided to concentrate on the IndyCar racing with their V6 Buick program, and they pulled out of Winston Cup to build some V6 Buick for Indy.
Looking back from Rusty Wallace as Bill Elliott hunts past on the low side. 397 laps complete. Bill Elliott, Davey Allison in Ford, Harry Gantz Oldsmobile, Mark Martin and Brett Bodine in T-Birds, Mike Waltrip, and then the rest of the top 10 a lap down. Kyle Petty's thoughts on 1992 as we go to this break.
This year is going to be tough. You know, you got Earnhardt, you got Elliott who went with the 11 car, you got Davey who's been hot since last June, you got Ernie in that car. I think Allen's going to have a good year this year. Buick is going to have a good year. There's 6 or 7 up through there that on any given Sunday is going to beat you like a ball.
PNN Motorsports live coverage of the Goodwrench 500 is brought to you by Kyle Petty and Mellow Yellow. There's nothing mellow about them. Battle for fourth shaping up here as Mark Martin of Abilene Ford number 6 being reeled in by Brett Bodine. And then Quaker State Ford.
Mike left to go, but Bodine was up beside him and tried to pass him. When he got up there, he lost a little bit of ground, but he's pulling him back in again.
We have the multi-viscosity battle here in a second.
Here the RC Brett's reeling him back in again. He got up there once, tried to pass him, and didn't make the pass and lost some ground, but it looks like he's reeling him in again.
Brett's coming along pretty well here. It is an all Ford show in the front five, but for Harry Gantz in third place.
Mike, when we talk about an all Ford show, this is hard to believe. But it's been, Chevy has not led a lap at this race today. And it's been since 1989, in June of 1899, that Chevrolet didn't lead a lap since that's been that long. That's a pretty good indication of what's happening. And I'll tell you what I think the big concern is, about this race is that, man, is this a handwriting on the wall for the season? And NASCAR has already said that they reevaluate after a certain number of races, and if a specific car has an age, they'll chop them back a little bit, and that's a possibility.
We saw there in traffic, Mark Martin got balked by a slower car there just a bit, and Brett Bodine is right there with him. Let's go back to 10th spot, where Darrell Waltrip and Rusty Wallace battle for 10th place. Chevrolet and Pontiac.
Oh, that's a good windshield.
How'd you like to look into that, Neil, going down in the first corner?
I've done it a few times, but I know you have too, buddy.
That's when you count to 13 and turn left.
Yeah. I used to follow that little white line on the inside, but every now and then it kind of runs up into that big white one on the outside if you're not careful.
Look at this. Is that a pretty thing?
I tell you what, at this racetrack, I've actually called a spotter and said, let me know if there's anybody in that corner. All you could see was just the edge of the racetrack, and I said, let me know if there's anybody in front of it, because you actually couldn't see them in the race. Now they know why I ran into so many of them, I guess.
Maybe so. For Ed from Indiana, all the GM cars in the race do use the same basic engine, the Chevrolet small block that debuted in 1955. At 350 cubic inches plus a little bit of overbore. But there are individual differences. There's no Olds engine anymore, no Pontiac engine, but there are some differences.
I'll tell you what, Pontiac has a specific head. They use a Pontiac head. It's an aftermarket head made by Brodex with a parts number on it. And Chevrolet runs a Chevrolet parts head. That's one of the big contentions now. They've got to decide which head to use. They're going to be allowed one of them, and they're going to have to stick with that one head.
Back to this battle for fourth between the two Fords.
I know they're proud to have this little fight going on. This is part of the time when you reach down, you say, well, the seat's hurting my back a little bit. Things just not going real well, and I'm not leading the race, and the crew's wanting to know, what can we do to put you up front? And you're going, look, don't talk to me. Let me think for a second. And then you call them back, you make an adjustment. But right now, they're proud to have this going on because it's aggravating when you can't close in on the leader.
Along with the fact that they just probably told them, you just have 100 laps left is all.
Yep, just. Like that 80 laps to go right now. There's a good one, Professor Baker.
Okay, lay it on me.
Joe from Delaware. Why don't these cars have brake lights? We get this question about once a year, but it's a good one, really, for folks that drive on the street.
Let me tell you why. I know these guys well enough to know if you got behind Earnhardt, he'd put that brake on about halfway down the straightaway with his left foot to make you think something was in front of you. You'd be dodging everything on the racetrack all day long.
Along with the fact I've never seen a brake light strong enough to stay on the back of one of these things. Somebody knock it off of there.
I think we found the reason.
See, that corner is dark now. That's totally different handling from the other end where the sun's down on it.
But it looks like when the 26 car can get right behind Mark, he can loosen him up. Watch Mark's car. It's been wiggling right here in the middle corner with that car behind him. And if he can do enough pressure on him, it's right there.
Woo, yeah.
See, that nose up under there broke him loose, and then he's able to drive up beside him.
He's going to let him go. He said, that's a little too much of a good thing there.
Yeah, you can see that coming the last couple laps. You know, Bodine played with that move and made him loose a little bit, and then he drove right by.
That move will put Brett Bodine up into fourth place. Behind Elliott, Allison, and Gant. With Mark Martin back to fifth. Sixth is Mike Waltrip. Seventh, Kenny Schrader, one lap down. Along with Terry Labonte and Ernie Irvin. Two laps back, Darrell Waltrip, Rusty Wallace, Hut Strickland, Rick Mast, Sterling Marlin, and Morgan Shepherd. Glenn?
Steve Bill, crew chief on Mark Martin's car. There's speculation up top that Mark's car's loose, but that's not the case.
No, we're too tight. We were good enough to beat everybody but the 11 and the 28 a while ago. So we take a chance to try to outrun them, and we went the wrong way, got them too tight. We're going to pit here in a little bit and fix it.
Okay, they're just waiting on that scheduled pit stop. He says they can take care of that and maybe make a shot at the leaders then.
One more pit stop for this race.
Could have fooled me. That's the first time I ever saw one push on the rear.
Bobby Hamilton makes the stop. He is the 19th place car. Four laps back. Now here's Harry Gant. He is in third place, but he's kind of lonesome out there. He's pretty much running all by himself. And when you see the groove he's taking in the corners, you'll see why.
Yeah, Harry just. For some reason, he likes to get up there in the uncharted places and just cut him a new trail, and he gets the job done up there all the time. Here's Davey down pit road.
Davey Allison in pit lane, second place car.
Mike, let's see if we can see if they do something to the chassis. They said they didn't want to. Let's see if Bill Elliott makes them do something. Bill was pretty well working on them, and see if these guys make any type of chassis change. I don't see them doing anything to the rear spoiler.
Nothing so far.
Not even leaning on it. They may be hoping the race will come to them. There's Joey Knuckles flying over the front of that car to hammer home the lug nuts on the left front.
The
just turn a jack screw on it. They didn't make a change. One thing Larry McReynolds does that no other, very few of the other guys do, with a radio, you can't do anything with stagger, but he works with air pressure. Stiffening the tire pressure a little bit will change the characteristics. He works that a lot. Here's the leader.
Well, here's Mark Martin.
Excuse me.
Who was the fourth place car. And Brett Bodine is also in. And no chassis change here either.
Well, if they didn't help Davey's car any, I heard the woman in the back room start to sing.
When?
Martin's car has come in for a four-tire change, and they did indeed put some bite, take some bite out of that car in the right rear. He's down and away now with a four-tire change, but they did make that chassis adjustment in hopes of loosening him up a little bit so he can get a little better speed through the corner.
Mike, something we noticed earlier on Elliott, we talked about him going a long run once before and falling back. Davey just pitted. Let's see if Elliott comes in here or tries to stretch it. When he stretched it before, it cost him track time.
Steve?
Here comes Harry Gant for his final pit stop of this Goodrich 500. No question, he'll get four tires, all the fuel it'll hold. The big question is, in this final sprint of the finish, can Harry Gant pull it out? If he can, he has to have a new nickname. He won't be Mr. September. He'll be a man for all season. Mike?
Summer, spring, fall, doesn't matter. Kenny Schrader is also in the pit. And Mike Walton, 22-second stop for Gant.
Here comes Elliott. Elliott's coming down pit road right now.
The race leader. Morgan Shepherd's also in. And let's go down to Glenn Jarrett.
Bill Elliott pulls that Junior Johnson-owned Thunderbird into the pit for his final stop. A four-tire change, and as we suspected, because he's doing so well out there, there is no chassis yet. They're going to let sleeping dogs lie, not going to mess with anything right now. They just want to get him out of here as soon as possible. A little bit of problem on the left rear lug nut there, but they got it off. Left side tires are going on the car. He'll be down and away here shortly. And he is out of here. Good pit stop. Under pressure.
Under 22 seconds. Darrell Walters in, so is Hunter Strickland. And Kyle Petty as green flag pit stops continue. To update you on Kyle trying for the third time to win this race from the pole and collect all that bonus money. He is back in 15th spot, momentarily three laps down.
And to answer a lot of questions, Elliott did beat Davey out by quite a good bit. He's still leading him by, looks like, about a quarter of a straightaway.
As green flag pit stops continue, we'll take a break to sort out the field. 400. 24 laps are complete. Bill Elliott with a 3.4-second lead. Here's the way they're running. We'll be back in a moment. Watching Mark Martin to answer a question from Charles from Decatur, Georgia about driver safety clothing. There you see a multi-layer Nomex fire-resistant suit and gloves. Mark's helmet, full-face helmet. Most all the drivers wear those now. And he's got a little breathing tube to get some fresh air into him. And, Buddy, you were noting as his hands come over on the right side of that helmet.
Yeah, you look at that head restraint right up on the right-hand side of his helmet up there. He's wearing that thing out. He's laying his head in that thing just like a holster.
Used to wear little straps, Buddy, under the arm, and this thing here, that little wraparound top around the side of his head there keeps that helmet from being so heavy, slinging his head to the right.
That's an appendage to the Butler-built seats that most of these drivers use that also now have leg extensions to protect the upper leg area.
That's a wonderful thing there. I used it in Atlanta, and I'll tell you what, it's a wonderful piece of equipment.
Well, Mark is running like a house of fire after pit stops. He's now the fourth-place car. He's moved past Brett Bodine and actually moved away from Brett. You see the rooftop camera right there at the top center of the windshield on Martin's car, and answer another viewer question. That really doesn't slow the car down much. It's aerodynamically designed to cut just as small a hole in the wind as possible. And Gary Nelson has tested that roof cam to make sure that the teams using it get no performance advantage from it. Kyle Petty on pit road, and this will all but end his hopes to take home $220,000 today. Pitting under green like this. Don't believe this is a scheduled stop.
I think he might be headed in.
I saw him waving his hand out the window as he went in there real slow. Something happened to the car. He's either out of fuel, or it might be out of fuel. It's not running right now. It's either out or something at the motor. Going down the hood. Blew up.
Goodbye, Greenback.
Yep.
That's an interesting fact. Only 5 of 26 pole winners have failed to finish this race.
I'm probably one of them.
Well, the bonus money for the pole winner to win the race will go up to $197,000 next week at Richmond. There are 39 drivers here that are happy Kyle Petty didn't win it. Did it twice in a row. Couldn't three-peat. Bill Elliott is trying to start a streak of his own here then. And knock down 190 grand in bonus, plus approximately 45, or not, rather knock down 45,000 for winning this race. He's not eligible for the bonus, just the pole winner. At fifth place, Mike Waltrip is catching Brett Bodine in the 26 car, the Quaker State Ford. Right in the middle of them is the ninth place car, and that is Terry Labonte in the Sunoco car. Glenn?
You can see the guys inside the engine compartment here on Kyle Petty's number 42 racer. The last lap by under Green when he came by, going into the first turn, the car misfired real badly. It sounded like a tire blew. They have changed the ignition. That's not the problem. They've got the distributor cap off now. One of the guys just made the signal that it broke, so I don't think they're going to get back out. This is looks to be a terminal problem for Kyle Petty.
Still working under the hood there. Now they'll roll it back. Tough day, but that string of luck ran out for Kyle Petty and the Felix Sabatis team. Trouble on the two car, and the hood, with all of that damage, looks like they're going to try to get it off.
Well, the hood was coming off. He had to come in and take it off. I guess he's going to run without a hood now for a while.
Well, that might cool it down a bit. Rusty Wallace.
That's more problems than just a hood, isn't it, Neil?
Yeah, they got a lot of steam. It's either steam or oil coming out of it one.
Now look at Terry Labonte's car. I'll correct myself. Top of the day, we said that was a Chevrolet. That is an Oldsmobile. Billy Higgins team. They're one of the teams still running old.
Mike, that's one thing about it. You know, with some of the involvement pulling back out, you're seeing some of these teams run a Chevrolet at one track, an Olds at another, and a Buick. A lot of the guys are switching back and forth.
Here's Brett Bodine, whose team has made the switch to Ford. And that's a major switch. That's not just sheet metal. That's engines. That's sheet metal. That's a lot of things.
And that's one of Ernie Elliott's motors. They have Ernie Elliott doing their motor program. So, but here he is. He's close to being lapped by Bill Elliott.
Coming up on Mike Waltrip, who is now the sixth place car. Elliott leads. Davey Allison in second. Harry Gant in third. Mark Martin in fourth. Brett Bodine in fifth. And at sixth place, the Pontiac of Mike Waltrip. About 50 laps to go here at the Rocks. We ask Richard Petty how he thinks he's going to get through the 92 season, his final one on the Winston Cup circuit.
You know, good Lord, give me 24 hours in this court and how I use it or how I let other people use my time. So, you know, we'll survive it. And maybe what we've got to look forward to is saying, okay, next year won't be as bad as this year.
Inside of 50 laps to go in the Goodwrench 500. There's one of the major players in the sport, Michael Krenefus, who came from Europe to oversee Ford's entire worldwide racing operation. Steve?
And it's really kind of comical to watch, Mike Joy. Michael Krenefus doesn't favor any of the Ford teams, and that's good business, obviously. He will spend precisely 5 minutes in the Allison pit. Then he'll walk up to Junior Johnson's Chapman Jr. on the wall for exactly 5 minutes and be right back here again. Back, and he's going to be worn out when this is over.
Got a lot of teams to pull for today, and a good number of them up front. Rusty Wallace is back on pit road. They took the hood off that car, and we speculated they've got more serious problems.
Yeah, they have a big problem. The nose of the car is mashed flat, so that's got to be making it overheat.
You're right, buddy. Here they go with the water hose. Going to try to cool it down. We could see Old Faithful right here when they take the top off of that thing. Yeah, he's taking the radiator hose loose. This thing's have a big AN fitting, and they're taking the hose loose itself.
no caps on these things, a sealed system, and he's going to have to take it loose and try to cool it down. Got a big wrench there getting it loose.
Coming up on 40 laps to go. Mike Walter about to be overlapped by Bill Elliott. You notice when Bill went to the Junior Johnson team, he did not take his number 9 with him. Car number belongs to the car owner. A lot of speculation about what will happen to number 43 next year when Richard Petty climbs out of the seat. Now, when Richard started racing, his dad was 42, and he just took the next number, 43, and ran one of his dad's spare cars in a lot of races. It was easy to change that back and forth. Speaking of 42, that number now is used by Kyle Petty. We'll go back to the garage area with a broken camshaft and out of the race today.
The number 43, they're probably deciding what to do with it. You know, even though Richard is, he's the car owner listed on that thing. He can put a driver in it with 43, but I don't know that they'll use that number.
Well, NASCAR has never retired a car number in the Winston Cup division. In the Winston Modified Tour, number 61 retired in memory of Richie Evans, a great multi-time champion. There is Richard, who will carry number 43 through this season and then hang up his helmet after Atlanta in what is sure to be a very emotional race. I don't know. Phil Parsons helping Richard along there just a bit. I don't know, buddy. Richard will have a car next year, and you'll always associate him with 43, but I kind of think that it would be a nice gesture if they took that number, hung it on the wall, and left it there.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, if any number in racing should be retired, that's it.
This will be the perfect opportunity to have the first time.
That's right. And plus, if he runs number 43 on his car next year, that would be awful tough on a young fellow. Just coming in to drive for Richard Petty is one thing, but coming in to drive car 43. Richard, one year, by the way, not too long ago, used 42. He had 43 on the winner's circle plan. So he put Kyle in 43 and put 42 on his own car to try to get a second car on winner's circle plan. NASCAR didn't like that very much. Three races later, he was back in 43 again.
They never have been known to take a joke real well, you know.
The King. A couple of laps down, he's in 16th position right now. By the way, all three-digit numbers were retired back in the early 70s. Another little trivia question. We'll give you the answer in a minute. The last driver to win a Winston Cup race with a three-digit car number.
Probably my dad.
Nope.
I know, can I say?
I know you know.
Tell it, man.
Neil can give a hint. And here's Kyle Petty climbing out.
I used to drive a car that had three digits.
Kyle, unfortunately, a $250,000 green just ended. What happened?
Well, we just messed the setup a little bit today. Could never get it hooked up. Now I don't know. Something broke. I don't know what it is.
You think you missed the setup because of the extreme heat that you're not used to seeing here this time of year?
No, I didn't have nothing to do with it. We just missed it, man.
Well, obviously, they didn't miss it in qualifying. End of the day for Kyle Petty, as they reported upstairs, a broken camshaft.
Track record in qualifying, 149.9 miles per hour. Here's Brett Bodine, the fifth-place car, getting lapped by Bill Elliott.
Kind of wearing him out, isn't he, Mike?
That's the truth. Back when the teams would go west to Riverside, California, and run the first and last race of the season, a lot of teams would take two cars, and the Wood Brothers would take number 21, and just so they wouldn't have to change the number on that second car, they just add one in front. And so car 121 was the last digit number to win. Here's the interval first to second. Bill Elliott back to Davey Allison, 4.6 seconds. And the man who won that race, Riverside, California, was the man who for four straight years owned the Motor Trend 500, Dan Gurney. 1968 was the year.
Okay, quite a racer.
We'll double check that interview. Interval. I believe we're a little off there.
If he closed up, Davey. If he closed it up, he was moving in a hurry.
6.4 seconds. First to second. Thanks, John. Down to the truck. They were trying to make this out to be a better race than it was. By about 2 seconds.
I'll tell you the tough part about this, Mike and Buddy, is that, you know, we're looking at, they just haven't been able to close any. It's been such a long run. I think if Davey had anything, he could come on that day. He's going to take something like a caution flag or on another pit stop just to make a major change on one of these cars to make a difference. And I doubt seriously they'll make one on this 11.
No way.
By the way, you'll hear more from Kyle Petty tonight on Inside Winston Cup Racing, a special live program tonight on TNN. Then Jarrett will have Kyle and Felix Sabati as his guests. And here's the Rusty Wallace car behind the wall. Glenn?
Well, we're with Rusty Wallace. Rusty just pulled the car in. What's wrong?
I don't know. It looks like he either got a hole in the radiator or a freeze plug or something that's losing water for some reason, and we can't figure out over there. It looks like they found the leak up there, but my day's about over today.
Well, is there anything that anybody can do with those Fords out there right now?
I can't hear you real good, but all I can say is the car was really well at the beginning of the race. They called us for running down pit road too fast. I know it wasn't, but that's racing, and we had an air gun brake on it today. But the car handled good, the motor ran great, and it's just unfortunate racing luck. Just like to say hello back to everybody at home and Roger and all of them watching. Too bad.
Disappointing day for Rusty Wallace.
Tough break in the engine department for Rusty Wallace. Puts him behind the wall with 30 laps to go. Bill Elliott is rearing him out.
I would say that is an understatement at this part of the race. Bill he's handling so well now. He goes up, right back to the bottom. The car's running flawless.
Take a little further back for Davey Allison, second. Harry Gant, third. And Mark Martin's fourth. They are all on the lead lap as Elliott extends his lead. One lap down, Brett Bodine is fifth, followed by Mike Waltrip, Kenny Schrader, and Ernie Irvin. Two laps back, Terry Labonte, Hut Strickland, and Darrell Waltrip. Three laps down. There's Davey Allison, 8.1 seconds back. Three laps down, Rick Mast, Morgan Shepherd, Sterling Marlin, and Jeff Bodine. Five laps down now, Richard Petty, Bobby Hamilton, and Ted Musgrave. Wally Dahlenbeck is nine laps, or rather Derek Cope is nine laps in rear. And Wally Dahlenbeck rounds out the top 20. Jimmy Spencer and Chad Little still running. So is Mike Skinner. Dale Earnhardt got involved in an accident with Alan Kulwicki. He's way off the pace. 23 laps down in 24th spot. Rusty Wallace just retired. Randy Baker still running. Give you a look here at the top 10, and we'll be back to the North Carolina Motor Speedway right after these messages with Bill Elliott opening it up. Tim Brewer, crew chief for Bill Elliott. What a matchup that has been. They were fast out of the box at Daytona. Ran well until that lap 92 collision that took several top cars out of the event. Came right back here to Rockingham and emerged with the dominant car. 21 laps to go, and he keeps opening up his lead over Davey Allison. Here is Mark Martin slowing down the fourth place car. Bobby Hamilton works his way by. Now here comes Ted Musgrave. And here comes Brett Bodine up on Mark, who is sawing at the wheel.
He's working now. Earlier, there's a thing going like he wanted. Now he's trying to work. There goes some bound outside. The 26 car was right behind him for position. Brett Bodine, we'll probably see him go out there on the outside.
That's fourth place right there.
Yep. Sounds kind of rattly to me, buddy, like something's wrong with the motor.
Yeah, it don't sound real healthy. I don't know what's wrong. I want to say hello to David F., my crew chief back at home, and Derek Cope. Close. I got it.
You better get it right.
Yeah, Derek Close.
There goes the 30 car by. Mark definitely got some kind of problem right now.
He has dropped now to sixth place. He's going to ride this one out. Let's go to Glenn Jarrett.
Well, Kirk Shelverdine. On behalf of Miller Genuine Draft, we're presenting you with the Miller Genuine Draft Pit Crew Award. You guys have persevered. You look like you need a break. That's pretty good work, the world's fastest brake job.
Well, thank you, Glenn. I guess we didn't win much else today, so this is a good award this season.
Okay, he said they needed some kind of good luck today. Maybe this will change their luck for the 1992 season from this day forward.
Well, here's a piece of bad luck. Brett Bodine's on pit road. He just moved up into fourth place. Here's the Kenny Bernstein car, the Quaker State Ford. Left side tire. Going to drop him a lap here. He was already one down. And And there's the NASCAR official. It's Walter Wallace there. Looks like WWE's going to put the watch and a penalty on him.
Yep, he's getting the penalty. He come in too fast.
Boy, I tell you, that's costly at a time like this. Get a 15-second penalty or some kind of deal for whatever the violation.
Too fast on pit row. We're inside, 20 laps to go, and Bill Elliott has made a shambles of this field.
Boy, Mark car is
still going. Yep.
As loose as can be, that car is all over the racetrack.
Let's get the story from Steve Evans.
Jack Roush, the 26 car, went by Mark fairly easily. Is there a problem with the car?
Well, we just run it real hard here, and we'd sure like to have a new set of tires right now. Mark just, I think, was a little hard on the tires there for a while, and we're needing a caution off of Ed.
Okay, you heard it. A lot of crews down here wish they could get a caution.
You know, we got several questions, and we used to kind of think it was a funny question, but now with this new pit road deal, why don't they put speedometers in these cars?
I don't want to know how fast I'm going.
Okay.
You know, in all actuality, the tachometer is just as good. Once they see with the gear ratio, that tach is just as good way to read it.
Yeah, if your street car has a tachometer, you know what it's reading when you're going 60 miles an hour. And so do these drivers.
Boy, Mark Martin's car is just dead in the water. If it's tires only, he doesn't have anything left because he's loose up the straightaway, but he's slipping all over the place. Well, this guy is slipping away, not all over the place.
Bill Elliott trying to win his first race for Junior Johnson. You know, when Darrell went over there and you, Neil, they were talking dream team. And for a while, you both had some great success over there, both you and Darrell. Talk about a dream team. This pairing looks like it's really hooked up.
Yeah, look back at Daytona. The two cars belong to Junior right there in contention, and they had the accident early in the race. So they've shown the ability to run up front at the two races they've been in. He's going. You know, Davey got a lot of streak. You know, he's sitting there running behind Bill, but, well, I tell you what, he's leading in the points, and if he finishes where he's at, he'll come out there in good shape. Looks like these Fords are going to be a handful.
First to second, 11 and a half seconds from Bill Elliott back to Davey Allison. There's Junior.
Oh, worry, Wart. Look at that face.
You can hardly tell the difference in losing and winning. It just never changes.
Victory lane, he'll crack a smile. 10 laps to go. There's Davey Allison, man who's trying to win two in a row.
You know, I'll tell you what, Davey's car just looks super. I mean, he's getting around the track good. Some days you just flat get out run. You know, I mean, Davey's car is driven well all day. Good power. It's just sometimes the guy gets hooked up and goes on. Boy, Davey never had anything to be ashamed of. That's a lot.
Sometimes, though, you feel like second place is no place.
You're right.
We see Junior a lot down in the number 11 pits. He divides his time pretty equally between Sterling's car and Bill's car, but usually as the race kind of settles off, he'll end up more down with the car that's in position to win. And today, that is Bill Elliott's car. Nine laps to go. That's Tim Brewer. Archie.
The good thing about this, Mike, is they have the luxury of enough lead to where he can back it down. When they start saying 8-10 laps to go, and you've got a big lead like he has, you can back it down a little bit.
Neil, you notice he's going in the corner, letting the car free up, going in. He's not abusing his tires at all. He has the lead now, and he's not doing anything to make the car loose or anything else.
And his line hasn't changed much, has
he? Same drift up now. He'll go right to the bottom here and come off a real nice arc off that corner. That's the way we teach it.
I'm taking notes.
What really helps though is to have a car that can aim in that direction and it'll do that.
Yeah, that helps.
Well, Bill Elliott may extend a trend started by Darrell Walton, who won his first race with Junior Johnson at this track at this race 11 years ago. Davey Allison in second. Harry Gant is the last car on the lead lap in third. There's Gant's Oldsmobile. Leo Jackson owns Skoll car. And Bill Elliott.
5 to go.
Looking at Bill handling so well. Bill's going to be the happiest guy here. The second happiest guy is going to be Mark Martin if the race is over, because he's all over this race.
He and Palicki and Earnhardt, who have soldiered along with bent broken cars, many laps down, trying to pick up points here. Looks like Davey Addison will leave here with the Winston Cup point lead. Running in second place right now.
That might make him a contender for the second happiest guy here.
Yeah.
Well, I tell you, when you come to Rockingham, the points thing really enters into it. To survive this race and get out of here in good shape is a key. And here they are, they won Daytona, finished in second. But if they finish second here, they'll have the leads, and that's a nice feeling.
Of the top 10 drivers in the point standings, only two of them are in the top 10 in this race, Davey and Terry Labonte, who's running in eighth place. Davey Allison will have, unofficially, a 56-point margin on Morgan Shepherd when we go to Richmond next week.
Which is a bunch in this type race.
Buddy, if you owned that car, would you be jumping up and down right now? And Junior's just so stoic standing there.
I tell you, Junior Johnson's done this enough that he don't have to react. It's part of the game plan for his cars to win races. But if I owned it, oh, yeah, I'd be doing a cartwheel down there. You can bet on it.
Koshiwuzu, the gas man for Robert Gates. Well, they've done their job.
White flag.
Ernie Irvin on pit road.
Must be fuel or something for him to stop this late.
One to go,
and he had to come in for fuel.
And nobody's there. They don't have it now. They found some. They weren't expecting it because, I mean, when he came down pit road, they were looking for a fuel can.
They don't know what he wants. There it is. It's a little gas and a little ether in the carburetor. And here comes Bill Elliott, poised to win his first race for Junior Johnson, and the Budweiser Ford takes home the laurels and the winner's share of the Goodrich 500.
Let's see if Junior's smiling there. I know Bill Elliott is.
Yes, sir, buddy. That's a good feeling this early in the season to get that one behind you.
Yeah, buddy, and also, you know, people certainly question Bill leaving his team that he's been with so long, and here he comes back and wins the race.
By 12.8 seconds over Davey Allison, Bill Elliott has conquered the rock. Ernie Irvin was in sixth place when he had to make that fuel stop. And Dave Marcus has received the Goody's Headache Award. Tough break, and I know he can use the cash, and of course there's a matching donation to Brenner's Children's Hospital in Salem, and the folks at Goody's.
No, that makes you feel good for Bill. Do you hear that crowd just in as he's coming down through there?
Talk about crowd, look at them.
Elliott the winner, Allison second, Gant third, Mike Walter fourth, Kenny Schrader fifth, Ernie Irvin will be sixth, Mark Martin seventh, Terry Labonte, Brett Bodine, and Hut Strickland the top ten.
You know, Mike, yesterday the guy that won the race couldn't find victory lane. This guy knows where it's at. He's been there quite a few times.
You bet. Richard Petty will finish 16th in this race. Darrell Waltrip 11th. Rick Mass 12th. Morgan Shepherd 13th. Jeff Bodine and Sterling Marlin the top 15.
You can see that smile through the helmet.
You bet. Steve Evans?
Well, Kyle Petty's reign here is over. The new ruler of the rock is Bill Elliott. Helmet coming off in victory circle. What a drive, what a perfect handling car, and what a wonderful job. Let's see if we can get him out of the car here before we talk to him. I'm out of breath. We had to run about 150 yards to get here, but it's worth every second of it. The crowd, did you hear the crowd applaud this guy? He is still one of the most popular drivers in all of stock car racing. This was a long, tough race. The temperature is much higher than anybody thought that'd be. It was certainly a nice environment for the fans and all of us, but maybe a little hotter in the car than it normally is. So, Bill, let's get him out of there if we can and have some fun with him. Okay, they're going to take a little time kind of debriefing Mr. Elliott, apparently, and he's got to get out of all the straps and all the things that keep guys safe in one of these stock cars. Junior Johnson, I hope he's not running as hard as we did down there. Now he's out, ladies and gentlemen, the winner of the Goodwrench 500. What a car, what a drive.
I'll tell you what, Tim Brewer, Junior Johnson, all the guys back in the shop did a heck of a job putting this piece together. We never touched it all day long. I told Tim yesterday afternoon, I said, I've never had a car that drove this good here. And I said, unless it totally goes to pot, I said, it's good. And I said, we'll just have to wait and see.
Well, I kept waiting to see some kind of a chassis adjustment, but they never touched it, as you said.
Well, it was a little bit tight at the first of the race, and then the racetrack loosened up, and it come right to us, and it went away from everybody else.
Only your second outing with Junior Johnson, you win this race. This team has a lot of chemistry and has got championship written all over it.
I'm telling you what.
And here's Tim Brewer coming in right now. Tim Brewer, comment from you real quick. Tim, great job on this car. The setup was perfect.
Well, you know, it's just one of those combinations. You know, you hit on, he never asked for a round of wedge. He did a super job, you know. He just sat in there. We got him behind a couple times, not getting some tires, but he's great. You know, he's the best.
Nobody's going to disagree with that. Glenn Jarrett?
Well, Davey Allison, it seems like it was only about 18 hours ago I was right here beside your car talking to you. Good solid run for second place there.
Yeah. You know, Texaco Havoline and Thunderbird hung in there all day today. We weren't tough enough to do anything with Bill, but he was awful strong. Got to congratulate him on a great run. You know, they're going to be tough the rest of the year, too. I'm just glad we got to jump on them in the points right now.
Well, speaking of that, you've got a great start to this year, a first place and a second place. We've calculated now you've got about a 56-point lead over the second-place man.
Well, it's awful early to be thinking about the points too much right now. We were going to test up at Richmond a couple weeks ago. Got rained out, so we're looking forward to going back there and see if we can be as strong as we were last fall, and we'll just try to keep running hard all year long.
Well, you've won at a lot of racetracks. You've had a lot of success early in your career. Is there anything you want more now than that Winston Cup Championship?
Yeah, I want to win a bunch of races first.
Okay, and I have an idea he'll do it, too.
I believe you're right, Glenn. We'll be back with more from the Goodwrench 500 at Rockingham right after these messages. TNN Motorsports exclusive coverage of the Goodwrench 500 is being brought to you by Havoline Formula 3 Motor Oil. Add more life to your car. By Miller Genuine Draft, cold filtered for real draft taste, so get out of the old, get into the cold. And by Goodyear, the unanimous choice of every NASCAR Winston Cup team. Steve Evans?
Well, we never got a smile out of this man all day long, but we're getting plenty of them right now. Congratulations, Junior. What a driver you got here.
Thank you. He did a great job, and we're tickled to death for him. Hope everything works out the rest of the year for us.
This is a great combination. I said this to Bill. The chemistry here seems to work perfectly. You and him just relate to each other.
Well, Bill and the crew gets along really good, and we basically have the same crew we've had, you know, all through our championship drives. There's a man here and there I left out eye that's went somewhere else. Now he's a crew chief or somebody, but our crew is basically the same one that we had. We won all the championships, and we just never did hit off with Terry, and we didn't hit off with Jeff. And Bill's just fill them shoes we've been looking for.
You've hit off with this driver, that's for sure. Let's go down to Glenn Jarrett.
Well, this happy-looking fellow here is the younger, and he says better-looking, Waltrip brother. That's going to cause a family problem here later on. But you had a good run out there today, Mike.
Yeah, we were real consistent. We were a little concerned when the race first started. We went back, but we adjusted the car. We had a really loose setup under it because we didn't want to slide the front end. And the setup came to us, and the further we went, the better off we got. Just want to thank the whole crew and Mark Cronquist in the engine room. That engine ran great all day long. We think we're going to be consistent and reliable, and today we did the same thing we did in Daytona, but we made it the last seven laps, so good day.
Well, you got to feel real good about this team this early in the year because you did have a good showing or good strong showing going at Daytona and in this good finish here today, so a lot of confidence going into 92.
It's a great team. Penske put a lot of faith in us, and we're going to prove it to them this year. You know, we had a good start last year. Things kind of mellowed out, but we had a change in the engine department. Now the guys in the engine room been together all along. We're real confident that this will last all season long. I want to say hello to Mom and Daddy and everybody in Owensboro, Kentucky. Glad I got that in there. Congratulate Bill Elliott.
Okay, back upstairs to Mike Joy.
Mike Walter moves up to sixth in the point standings. Here's the finish of the Goodwrench 500. These results are unofficial. Bill Elliott, Davey Allison, Harry Gant finish on the lead lap. Mike Waltrip is fourth. Kenny Schrader is fifth. Also in the top 10 today, Ernie Irvin, along with Mark Martin, Terry Labonte, Brett Bodine. They were a lap down. So was Hut Strickland and Darrell Waltrip.
Two laps back, Rick Mass, Morgan Shepherd, Jeff Bodine, and Sterling Marlin. Three laps down to the King, Richard Petty. Ted Musgrave was back six at the finish. Bobby Hamilton, Derek Hope, and Jimmy Spencer rounded out the top 20. A little further back, Wally Dahlbeck, 21st today. Chad Little, Mike Skinner finished the race. So did Dale Earnhardt. Randy Baker, top 25 finish. Rusty Wallace parked his car. Jerry Hill was running. Ricky Rudd, Kyle Petty in the garage, and Phil Parsons with that car torn up from the collision. Alan Kulwicki soldiered on to finish 31st. Dan Smith, Jimmy Means, Greg Sachs in the garage. So was Dylan McCallert at the finish of this one. Dick Trickle and Dale Jarrett, Andy Belmont, Dave Marcus, and John McFadden all made early exits from the event. The Winston Cup points going to Richmond will have Davey Allison on top and Morgan Shepherd in second. Bill Elliott is back 88 points behind the point leader, back about sixth. And Earnhardt is going to have to play some catch-up. He's 131 points back. Final thoughts, Neil Bonnick?
Well, I think we see the handwriting on the wall. Fords are going to be exceptionally strong, and also Bill Elliott and Junior Johnson.
Buddy Baker?
Yeah, but don't get used to Earnhardt staying that far back in the points. He's going to still be a factor, believe me.
For Neil Bonnick and Buddy Baker, topside. For Steve Evans and Glenn Jarrett on pit road, this is Mike Joy congratulating Bill Elliott on his victory in the Goodwrench 500. Next Saturday, tune into TNN for live Busch Grand National coverage from Richmond, Virginia.